at Transmediali in 2011. And this is my latest VR avatar, AR avatar. I'd be very happy if I could always have an avatar, but apparently we haven't quite blended the virtual and offline worlds to that extent. So that's where I'm at, and trying to think about logic for creating with a sort of set of rules from a computer. And I'm super excited to see Thor Magnusson has just received an amazing research grant for his ongoing digital music AI experiments. And really, really happy to be here and interested to hear what everyone's doing. So stop sharing my screen. Don't know if anyone has any comments or questions, or if we move on to that later, Amanda.
I think we can move on to that later.
Perfect.
I think we'll have time for conversation. We'll have a couple of presentations and then conversation and take breaks throughout. So thank you, Jody, for that awesome presentation of where you're at the moment.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Amanda.
Mia.
Hello.
How are you? Would you like to talk about where you're at the moment and when you were involved in Pixelache?
Actually, I was more prepared to talk about the old days.
Please do, Mia.
Maybe I start from there and then talk about now, because there's where to begin. But to go straight to the point. Welcome, everybody. Hello from Turku, Finland. And basically, I guess I'm here because I participated to Pixelache Festival in 2003, and I'm going to share a screen for you. Wait a minute. Here. Can you see it? Can you see it?
We can.
Okay.
Thank you.
So I was solo those days, and I was performing with DJ Mortensen. We were both living in Barcelona. And the text here tells a lot. Essential energies, low-tech pixel art, all kinds of cool stuff we were doing those days. And I went to the archive and Wayback Machine to see if I have any photos. And I found my old website, which is like this. So there was a lot of stuff going on, and it seems like I was trying to do Instagram before social media in a way. So I was always putting a lot of photos. And basically I had my first kind of tour, European tour, as a kind of solo act with Mitt Mortensen, and Helsinki was on our way. That first we went to Vienna, then Zagreb, then Pixelache and Brussels. And I actually found the photos there in the archives. And you can see the aesthetics already. That was really, really kind of low tech. And just showing some pixels, because also those days, I guess the networking between these different places like MAMA in Zagreb and Pixelache in Helsinki and, you know, Simatics in Brussels, it was very, very crucial. Because I feel like these festivals, it was not even so much about the performing, it was more like the hanging with the people. And most of the people I met there, I also did something together in the future. So here we see like Zagreb MAMA people, and then we come to Helsinki. And we were staying at the Suomenlinna. It was kind of freezing still, like a bit snow or something. Here are the photos from our performance in Kiasma. Kind of like some kind of, you can see pretty pixelated, kind of 8-bit stuff even. And no wonder, because those days the videos were like 320 times 240 pixels, so I had to blow up the image like double for the projector. So it was like my computer was struggling, but anyway, to do even that. So nowadays it's very difficult to even show these works or videos, because they're so small in the size. But anyways, what I remember from Pixelache Festival, for example, there was Sonny De Camso, there was Avi Centralin from Stockholm. They were doing like really like shooting material, doing live cinema, really live, like doing cinema. Like everything was kind of not just presented, but also produced in real time. There is Juha Huskonen with a nice haircut. and then the Moment Factory from Canada, and then of course the Pixelache Club. And I was just remember we were having such a great time, absolute fun. We were even thrown out from a nightclub in Helsinki. Never happened after that or before. But I also saw some pictures from Simatics, because Simatics Festival in Brussels was also organized first time the same year, the same month. And also I've seen like Simatics and Pixelache had a lot of like a parallel trajectory in how they evolved in time. So yeah, lots of fun. And also Simatics was more like club scene, and I guess we were performing at Kiasma around 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. So I wouldn't say it was a huge like like success in public wise. So also I was wondering like why I smile when I think about 2003. It was and why I feel like there was so much excitement those days towards this live audiovisual scene. And it was all kind of new, and it was like made possible through these first laptops. You know, I had this black, I don't remember the name even, the black laptop from Mac, the early ones. And also what was very interesting, sorry about that. What I was doing with that laptop was I was using this NATO software, which is basically an artwork. I don't know if you heard about this. It was made by Netoska Nesvanova, name is Nobody, from Dostoevsky's book. And it was kind of very cryptic software. And the maker, who I know who he actually is, actually managed to piss off many mailing lists and thrown out and caused a lot of havoc and kind of activity in many ways in media scene in those days. So I was kind of happy to be one of the members of the court of Netoska Nesvanova. And also about this networking, apart from all this networking that Pixelache was doing, like all these kind of other pixel events in around the world, but also the software. This software created a network of people. It created a community because it was so difficult to use. We organized meetings to like learn together and so the NATO people knew each other. So, and it continued for years, even after the NATO didn't exist anymore, because then came the jitter and everything was commercial again. So yeah, so that's also part of that kind of excitement. There were a lot of going on. And actually, when I mentioned this old Mac laptop that had its glory days in 2003, that laptop was actually opened up at the Pixelache event called Diggers in 2014, because there was this recycling, that digging for gold from computers are organized. Also Andrew was part of it, so there was a kind of like two events for that laptop at Pixelache. So yeah, this is my website nowadays. It's a bit different than 2003. I would say like I actually did the live cinema very actively until 2010, after which I dedicated most of my time towards more like investigative works. Actually, thanks to Ulla Taipale, who invited me to artistic expeditions to the Baltic Sea in 2000 and taking part in 2011 in Finland. So this was the project here, Green Matters, that started my kind of new career, which I'm still like working on lately. What can I say? I usually work very long time in a subject. Like for example, I was investigating honeybees since 2016. I became a beekeeper to be able to document the activity. I wrote a cultural history thesis on the history of honeybees in Finland. So that took many years, and I also had an exhibition here in this photo, like installation about this work, History of Impossible Destiny, and the Contemporary Museum, Art Museum of Santiago in Chile, 2019. After which I worked on another species, which was Kiljuhanhi in Finnish, but it's like a lesser white-fronted goose. Very few people probably know this goose species, but that was also actually still in a video installation in Art Hall Seinäjoki, Kunsthalle Seinäjoki, until January 2021. So that was my latest. Here is the photo of that one. And right now I'm working on minerals, and it should be ready in a couple of months. So it's been very kind of work-wise busy year in a way. And yeah, so I guess I could leave it here.
That's amazing. It's lovely to see that arc of practice. And I that was my first year living in Helsinki in 2003. So I remember that festival well. But it's really nice to see the arc of your practice from then until now. Thank you very much, Mia.
Thank you. I'm just trying to find a way to stop. Okay, stop sharing that. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. I believe that Adam Somlai Fisher has joined us.
Yes, hi guys. Hello everybody. Hey Amanda.
We'd love to hear from you.
Hey Adam.
Thank you. Hi. Thanks, yeah. Amanda, Andrew, Jodis. Let me actually do a little trick and yeah. Sharing ourselves here. Hello.
Hi.
So Adam.
I'm Anita.
And we joined the first Pixelache in 2003. And we had this installation that we called Distributed Projection Structure, which was really the first thing we did in our careers that was a bit more international and visible. So we were extremely happy that people liked it. And with Anita, we worked on it. And then with Peter, who's near us right now. And you know, it was like this Math projection, but we also built a special sculpture that was, you know, specially designed to match the algorithm. It was a bit before the projection mapping movement. So anyhow, this is still very dear to our heart. And then as the years passed, we did a lot of things in a lot of places, and we don't really want to get into it in these few minutes now. Right now, what is really interesting for us is like two things. One is that a decade ago, I started a company with two friends called Prezi, and this is our team more or less now. You know, we worked very hard doing this startup thing, but my special role has been in the last few years in innovation. You can see Prezi Labs out there. And I'm working with how augmented reality can be used for self-expression, because in the Terminator and these kind of visions, it's used for surveillance, and it's not a nice thing, but I think it can be used for self-expression. And you know, the other thing that we do nowadays is, these are our kids. And we, just a few months ago, we started homeschooling them, like science and creativity. And with the pandemic on, we just moved to Barcelona and we are trying ourselves. And I did a big mistake. I mixed up the times and I thought we are 1 hour ahead. And I even organized Peter, our third collaborator, to join us for this call. But he's busy right now, so I just quickly took a picture, the thing that he wanted to show. So he moved to Barcelona and he opened this really amazing handmade candy store where he makes candy by hand, sugar candy. And this one is his daughter, Sol. And this is actually a little pig that's been blown with air, kind of like, you know, how you make glass, but it's made of candy. Just, he's experimenting on these things right now. And it's my mistake that he just, yeah, he wanted to say hi and maybe he can join a later slot. I will try to see that with Andrew. But this is where we are, this is who we are, and we'll be lifelong grateful for Pixelache because it has been an amazing first opportunity for us and an amazing network of friendships and great authors. And thanks, Juha, for many years of inviting us to different festivals. That's all we wanted to share in this quick shot.
No, it's fantastic. It's exactly perfect. Thank you very much, Adam.
Thanks, Amanda.
And I hope that Peter can join us later too, because we'll have presentations, but we'll certainly also have time for conversation and discussion. Andrew, can I draw you into the conversation now and talk a little bit about where Pixelache has been and where we're and where you're heading?
Oh well, I could say that as one of the longer members, I've been involved as an organizing contributor since 2004, but attended 2003 first time. I've followed all the different developments as we've had over the years and had many different roles, but together with Ante Ahonen and now with several other members, Vishnu Varhade, Agnieszka Pokrówka, Arlene Tucker, Tuomo Tamempa, we're starting to think about how do we deal with the archival sides of the festival, and also how do we look back at the years, make accessible things which happened quite a long time ago now for newer members, because one of the features of the organization has that over now 18 years we've had many different changes of active members, and the current active group actually are very different profiles than we have started with. So as a way to fold past into present and understand the changes that have happened over the years, what affordances we've had, the different capitals that we have gained over the years that allow us to keep going. It's a good exercise to try to think, how can you archive but also create something new out of things? And Ante Ahonen and I in particular, we often exclaim that archiving is deadly dull, it's deadly boring, and we have to try and find some way to make it interesting, right? For us to do it, but also for anyone else, right? And I like to think that this event is just one part of a process to figure out how might you look back at their current time, as well as to help create new narratives and spaces for people in the future. So this is why we are here at this very moment. I'd like to take away some space, go back to the background, and hopefully the next speaker.
That sounds like a perfect moment to invite Antti to come and chat to us about where he's at the moment. And Antti, you with us?
I think he'll just be a little bit late, but he'll join soon.
Oh, okay. Is this the moment to take a quick break then?
I'm here.
Antti is here, great.
Sorry, yes. Antti.
Yeah, it's okay. Just it's always hassle with this program stuff. Okay, maybe I'll even put on the video for a while. Can you see me?
Okay,
hello. I didn't make any presentation, but I'll just talk a bit about because I've been on the Pixelache thingy from the start, and I've been in kind of the different roles throughout the years. One of these is I'm the photographer. I've been photographing all the festivals and most of the events, and but I've also been involved as both artist in going through some old catalogs. I just realized I've been on the VJ side of the program also, but mainly through the Association of Experimental Electronics that has been doing very large variety of things throughout the years, from workshops to concerts to collaborations with different people and some exhibitions also, I think. I've been part of this like organizing body, and I've created some events throughout the years, and Andrew mentions, I spend incredible amount of my time in the archives. There is the archive. It is again doing something there in the background, as it pretty much all that I have, like I don't even remember how many I have, like maybe 5 computers around the house, and at least 2 or 3 of them are doing some strange archival tasks pretty much all the time. So I like, this is how I'm living. I'm living in this endless fear of archival. Today I'm like, in a way I do pretty much same stuff that I've always done. Like I'm still in this Pixelache circle, and the Koelse is still working. We just started the Museum of Paranormal Technology at our studio, but now we're on a small break because there's this corona stuff. But yeah, and I do different kinds of photography projects. Not that much involved in the VJ scene as I was in the very 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 early days of Pixelache. Although I've been trying to reintroduce some VJing related issues on the Pixelache stream of things, but I don't know. Do ask me if you want to know about something.
I think that's a moment. I think that's a great moment for us all to maybe just generally open up the floor for a 10-minute kind of break from presentations and have conversation and say hi to one another and top up your coffee if you're me, because you're in New York and it's morning time. But hello, everybody. It's so lovely to hear some stories, and we'll take take 10 minutes, and then we'll come back to the next group of speakers, beginning with Juha, who can talk about the history and where he's at the moment. For 10 minutes, everybody, just say hi.
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 Really,
hi. Hi.
Everybody's faces.
Hi.
Hi,
Jack. Hi. Jody.
Hi.
Auntie. Christina.
Hey.
Yeah. Wow, Pete.
Wow.
Hey, hello, everyone.
Hello. Hola.
Hello.
So cool.
Photo time.
Hey everyone. Hey everyone.
Hey.
Hey Jody, nice to see you.
You too.
Missed your presentation.
Oh well, I'll recreate it for you, an interpretive dance, as we like to say.
I'm teaching, so I'm kind of on a lunch break, but I'll come back later.
Goodie.
Excellent.
Isn't that the Hell Hotel behind you, Jody? The hotel
in
Hell? Is the hotel in Hell still that you're staying in?
I'm out of Hell now. Thank you, Adam. Now I'm in Trondheim, which is far, far from Hell. There's my little North Star.
Right.
Yeah. Move north, but not quite back to Helsinki. Hey, how's your plan? Oh, I guess I should check in off group. Your moving plan.
We all want to hear.
Someone's moving to Berlin, I heard, maybe.
Hey, sorry, slow to catch up. Yeah, we're in Barcelona for the moment. It's actually quite sunny here and you can have be in a t-shirt outside, so.
Nice.
Sorry.
Oh yeah, Vishnu wants to know where everyone is living right now.
Still in London.
Nice.
Warsaw, Poland.
Zoom.
Someone says, yo, what's up? Steve, do you want some
snack? Yeah. See, would you
like some
coffee? This is going okay.
Like the stream?
I can hear you. I know.
Good.
Really? Are you still doing those drone cameras? Really? Really?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is that a room full of drone cameras that you're in?
This is a room full of more like instruments and tape machines, but
nice.
I had this kind of really intensive 8-year kind of arc of doing mainly the drone camera stuff, but now I'm being a bit like gotten bored with it, so shifting back to my original love, music and arts.
Oh, wonderful. Glad to hear that.
And it was a good timing because, like, also this the whole COVID thing would have ruined my plans much worse if I would have been still totally dependent on the film work.
Yeah.
But I'm still doing it time to time.
Well, I guess it's good because, you know, it's good for distance filming, so.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah. Cool. Well, I'm looking forward to hearing what you've been making with your music and art there.
I will show and tell.
Excellent.
Ella will be presenting very shortly.
Yay.
Ooh.
I'm in the middle of teaching a class, so it will back in 10 minutes, so I'll have to duck out and I'll come back later.
Cool.
Quite soothing, the sound of someone typing over Zoom, I find.
Was it? That was me, sorry.
No, I'm genuinely, I like it. I've been doing so many classes on Zoom, I'm just used to there being people around doing things.
Yes. My Zoom class is 32 students. That's quite
What are you teaching, Amanda?
Understanding new media, just undergrads.
Yeah. Oh, excellent.
It's my main class. I do a bunch of
Amanda,
what is new media these days?
We cover everything from we do some early cyber feminism, but I'm also very excited with the new glitch feminism book that's been written, that's just come out from a young New York curator who's totally brilliant. We do Afrofuturism because I'm in America and it's really important to think about that in that context. We cover bio art, but we go right back. It's an undergrad class. So, yeah, what is new media? Good question. I think it's a really... we cover everything from computer graphics to kind of bio art, I guess, is the breadth of the material. But we talk about ideas more than anything. What's new media to you, Juha? Or maybe this is a moment to ask you where you're at and what you're up to, and you can give your little presentation.
So, yes, so I have to say that this question, what is new media? I mean, I haven't been pondering that one. I used to be thinking of that for a long time, but not recently. Okay, let me see. I'll try to switch off my video. On the video, hey. Nice to see many familiar faces. It's very confusing as well, so many familiar faces suddenly. So I'll try to briefly share some things that I'm working on, and these are actually, I feel that I'm kind of somehow have gone through a certain cycle with things. So actually I've been kind of returning to this sort of Pixelache, like things that I was involved in the Pixelache days. And let me see, I'll try to share my, okay, this is it. And here, yeah. Can you see? Nope.
Yep, we've got your
screen. Voila. Okay, very good. So I realized that I have quite a few slides. So it'll be like a rabbit slide show, not as fancy as Adam's presentation. So this is maybe I should to sort of mention, and some of you know this, is that like 15 years ago, me and Adam, we were both developing our own presentation systems, like these sort of fancy zooming presentation systems. And we were kind of going in different events and kind of comparing how the presentation systems were evolving. But then at some point things diverged, so my presentation system didn't evolve, but Adam went ahead and set up this global presentation empire. So, and it's lovely to see that things are still evolving. So basically today I wanted to share two things. The one is the sort of the ecology topic, and the other one is related to Suomen Linna, which is one place where Pixelache was hosting a lot of things. So so related to ecology, like for me, the like one starting point is before Pixelache, there was this event eco.catastrophe. There was this collective called Catastrophe, and we did this project in 99, sort of dealing with this topic of ecology in various ways. This is 2008, Noir Vert, the Green Cloud. This was this big Pixelache project. And then there was this seminar, Traveling Without Moving, in 2008. So this sort of topic that certain practices should change, this was, we had discussed in 2008. I think it's very topical right now, since we cannot move. But basically for me, there was this period of 10 years of, and this was really like the Pixelache period, when there was this topic of environment and ecology was important, but it was mostly just discussed. But then me myself, I was just like traveling like crazy all the time, and basically these discussions didn't really influence my own practice. But then now at HIAP, So I've been now the director of HIAP now. Yeah, this is now the seventh year. So basically, after Pixelache, via some transitions, I ended up at HIAP. And this is a project that we started 3 years ago called the Post-Fossil Transition Project. So this was at the point when HIAP was preparing its 20th anniversary. So we tried to think of HIAP in year 2038 of what would make sense to do now that would seem relevant 20 years in future. And then we started this project called Post-Fossil Transition with Mustarinda, this other presidency organization. And we have these three topics: travel, energy, and food. And the goal has been to actually change the way we work as an organization, not just to talk about things, but actually change things. And we've made these three posters. These are online and these are also on the wall. So in terms of food and energy and travel, we made these quite, these are very simple, mundane things and quite obvious things, but actually changing them is not so easy. So basically it has been a lot of work. Like, I think the best example, if I go back to energy. So now after 3 years, the thermostats in our studios have been changed. So we can then have a more steady heating, and then the heating can be then lower, and it will still feel nice and warm, but it won't go up and down. But it took 3 years to convince the governing body of Suomenlinna to change the thermostats. So, so there was a lot of. I mean, I think this has been the kind of the overall theme that if you want to spend less energy, then you actually, you need to do quite a lot of this work in order to get there. And often where you get is actually doing less and kind of achieving less. So it's this sort of I think degrowth is then kind of one word for this, but it's really this sort of transition that we've been going through. And I'm happy to say that we've kind of managed to do quite a bit. So especially with travel, we've been traveling, especially I stopped flying, so this was quite a big thing. So I've taken just a couple of flights, so I didn't go down to zero, but for my standards, a massive change. And what we've done is that we put together this page that has like a information kit of how to travel ecologically to Helsinki. So often if one is interested to travel ecologically, it's kind of difficult to find all the information. But now that we focus on Helsinki, we know what kind of boats are coming to Helsinki. We know all the connections, so we can actually give like very detailed information of how one can travel ecologically to Helsinki. And then Trans-Siberian train, that's something that we've had already some trips via the Trans-Siberian train. I was supposed to do my first trip this spring. It was obviously canceled due to the obvious reason, but I'm hoping to do it still in future. So in terms of our collaborations, we'll be doing quite a lot in the east, because we can take the train through Russia and China to go east. And then what is quite exciting, and this could be like a longer story, but I'll just briefly mentioned this. So this is a photo from backstage of this seminar that we just had. It was HIAP and Frame and Mustarinda and IHME. So four art organizations. We've kind of all made the same commitment that we actually changed the way we work into actually to actually drop the emissions. And we had the minister of environment taking part in the seminar as well. So yeah, so Finland is a small country. So if we as art organizations, if we do some things, we can actually then get into discussions with the actual decision makers in Finland. So I think even though we are small, I think there's a chance that we can actually have some influence on things. And there's especially this small think tank called BIOS. They are actually advising a lot of the political parties on these issues. And one of the key persons in this think tank, Antti Majava, he's also a member of Mustarinda Artist Residency and so on. So there's quite a lot of this. Yeah, it's a small country, so the connections are quite tight. And then I'll try to be very brief, not to go much over time. So the other thing that I wanted to mention is related to Suomenlinna and also this perspective of, I guess, archiving and looking back and looking to the future. So we just had this exhibition of wrapping up this post-fossil transition project. And this one particular thing that we featured was this event from 1968. This is a magazine related to that event. It's a quite, the magazine itself is quite spectacular. There is articles in Finnish and English and Swedish and Norwegian. It's made by the Scandinavian Design Students Organization, which is a very, I think, was very Pixelache thing at the time. So this was this moment when it was impossible to get training as an industrial designer in Finland. But these young students, they wanted to establish that type of education in Finland. So they were the ones who organized this event in Suomenlinna, and they were the ones who put together this publication. And they had, it was both about this, like really about innovation, about this really thinking out of the box, but also about solidarity and responsibility. So what is quite amazing is that, yeah, so these are some photos from Suomenlinna. So this took place during the summertime. It was very kind of relaxed, informal event. And what is quite amazing is that Buckminster Fuller was there. So he was one of the keynote speakers. And this was the moment when this was the moment just before the first trip to the moon was about to happen. So all the speculations was around traveling to space. And also there was a lot of scenarios that people would live undersea. This was like a hot topic. So there was, yeah, a lot of this innovation, but there was also this sense that what would happen rapidly is that this industrial design would become more commonplace, would become like a global force. And this was this moment when it was this realization that this is the moment to really shape the way things will go in terms of industrial design. So, and to me it was, yeah, I mean, all the discussions, the spirit of the discussions was very similar to this like early era of Pixelache, like this early era of all these tools coming up and a lot of freedom still to imagine of what this could be. And in terms of archival, what is amazing is that all of the presentations were recorded and then transcribed. So there's four books that have all the presentations and discussions from this event. And I'll wrap up with this one photo because there's a sort of a nice Pixelache link So this is a photo from 1968. So Viktor Papanek is there on the left. So he was not well known writer back then, but after the event, a couple of years after the event, his first book came out, and then after that, he's been a well-known design theorist. Yrjö Sotamaa is on the right, so he became the dean of University of Art and Design. And then in the middle, it's Henrik Wahlfors, a designer from Sweden who passed away a few years ago. So he was one of the presenters. And he happens to be the father of Erik Wahlfors, who was an active Pixelake participant during the Kiasma years. So both as a performer with this act Fors, but also in the discussions. And then Erik then later on was one of the co-founders of SoundCloud, and now has this a new startup going on. So yeah, it's all kind of small circles when it comes to time and space and so on. So I think that's all from me.
Oh, that was a beautiful way of looking back very much for the history and for also beautiful ways to think about speculative futures, both in the work that you're doing at the moment. That was a really lovely way of wrapping backwards to move forwards, which I think is really important to what we're trying to achieve today. Thank you for that awesome presentation, Juha. And Petri Laivonen, can I call on you to come to speak next?
Yes, that's possible. Okay, hello everyone. My name is Petri Laivonen. Let's see if I can get some screen sharing going on. Yeah. Goody good. So this is a nice opportunity and an important event actually to be able to gather like this and discuss. And now I just realized that how important this is, and you could, you know, gather the, like, make some historical remarks or even write some history of Pixelake in these kind of situations. But it's always really difficult and almost impossible to like compress everything into so small pieces. So I will tell something. First, I will tell something about like myself and where I'm now. And then I like to reflect on the like the spirit of the Pixelake as I saw it when I was present there in the beginnings from the 2002 to maybe 2010 or something when the family and stuff got in the way. But yes, for me the interesting thing about Pixelake is it's like it's really difficult to define what it is, and there were lots of people and they just like appeared to those events and those organizations. And then you might never hear about them again or something. So it's like there are all kinds of potentialities present all the time in life and in societies in general. And for me, example, there were a lot of students. I was a student, I'm now like 41, so I was like 30 or 23 or something at that point. And I was then studying at, and I graduated from the industrial engineering and management, and it was like a, you know, strategic management and really like different kind of stuff. At the same time, you know, we were with Juha doing like really like alternative or fringe or some creative stuff abroad. And then later I founded a Screen.io, which is like a company, that small company that, for example, our software is used in universities in Finland, just like anonymous chat and polling and that kind of stuff. But I like to keep it simple and simple and small. And then in the meantime, I helped Esa Saarinen in his philosophy lectures in Aalto University or somewhere, and it was quite nice and successful. That's kind of like life lifting things. And now lately, maybe in 15 years, I've been helping this emeritus professor Heikki Hyötyniemi in his cybernetics, artificial intelligence, all kinds of stuff, but in a really weird way. I don't know what will happen with that. Maybe we'll wrap up in 1 or 2 years, and then maybe I'll write a few papers about it. I don't know. But then let's see about my ideas about Pixelache. Let's see, I will stop the sharing so you can see me. Pretty good. So I will only speak for myself, of course. I haven't analyzed Pixelache much with like collaborators. I've seen Juha maybe once a year or two, which has been splendid. Then family happened. Juha was my best man actually, and Ville provided the sound to the wedding. But during the first years, there were maybe 10 of us or something. It was voluntary hobby work much, and there was much background work, and that's really nice for me. Especially, I don't like streaming live. This is like a completely different thing that I'm usually like doing. I like to think of things and polish them and stuff. But there were a lot of opportunities in these kind of festivals. Not everybody needed to be on the front. For example, me, sometimes it was my label was head of special operations, you know, when things happened, you had to, you know, get a taxi, go somewhere or fix some things or something. And the main thing, if I reflect back, was this alternative fringe versus like mainstream thing. It's like a difficult to analyze, but for me it was about correlations and coherence, and even like avoiding too much correlations and too much coherence. You know, it was like if you get too much like correlations, it gives too much energy, and it's then difficult to get those emergent structures going on, that lived present that happens. You know, if you have to, we try to stay away from too like strong topics or something that would bring like, you know, outside powerful forces into the festival and bring some divisiveness or something, because there's so many potentialities, so many ways of looking at things, and that way like avoiding correlations. Even sometimes I remember we were thinking about media artists and media scene, and we were like a bit deliberately like avoiding like too much like media artistness. So if somebody was like, or some organization was like too polished or too like marketable or too like professional, it was somehow a little bit like suspicious or something. So because it and it was in the if I reflect it back, it might have been like a good move, because it was easier for the, you know, all kinds of, you know, academics or scientists or hobbyists or just like ordinary thinkers to come and do stuff. And then the other thing about that was that this creative tinkering, creative misuse of technology, it was not only, there was some like even academic thinking behind it, because I was back then, I was in these strategy studies, and these in strategy, in corporate strategy, the network effects and the positive the network externalities that are present, they have been studied, you know, tens of years, and we could see with Juha and others that it has brought great things in the industry, you know, because you standardize things and things get cheaper, for example. But then when you start standardizing words, or you start standardizing, you know, user interfaces or things, how people like communicate, you start standardizing those, then the dominant designs that come, they start like affecting what much more about to what kind of media and stuff, what people even discuss about. And that was like a great concern for us. So we brought, you know, Wikipedia in and had 3D printing and all kinds of stuff. That was like, that was easy from that kind of a philosophy point of view to like somehow like bring like new energy to the or somehow not be too coherent, not be too like too much energy to the one thing. And of course for us it was also there's some basics in Finnish demo scene. So many of us were like hobbyists in home computer culture in Finland and elsewhere. So we were like tinkering with home computers and having this, you know, for us the internet was, you know, BBS or bulletin board systems where one people could call at the time, you know, and the sysop would moderate it. And nowadays, what would you recommend to kids? Instagram or something. So it's completely like different media landscape, but we wanted to somehow, you know, bring it. You can see it from those PEP pictures also from the projects, for example, that Mia Mäkelä's wonderful, which had that kind of wonderful like variety or lifelikeness in her website. That somehow misses when you have like standardized UIs everywhere in the world nowadays. And then like family happened and people went to many people, some people continued in the media artist scheme, but some people also went to the industry. So now I have friends, for example, in like Supercell, but what can they do? You know, micropayments and free-to-play model dominates and something. Or I have a friend who was in Pixelate now in Facebook, and what can he do? You know, just, you know, enjoy the benefits and hope not to make too much damage in total. And now I'm like really like into like local action. So friends and local and really local. Like I have a few blocks here between my home, which is next block, and then the kindergarten and school and stuff. And then there are a lot of families that, you know, that we have, we get the kids to the school and go to the forest. Forest is there and stuff like that. And then, but in all, like you need time and presence to create something and develop something like this. And we were utilizing like Finnish student system in a sense, hopefully creating something good in exchange of that freedom. And also important is acknowledge that many of us are really like, I don't know the word, but like privileged, like living in Finland and all. I lived in a small one room apartment in the center of Helsinki with all my books, but small expenses, being students, lots of time to concentrate and stuff. And for me, the Pixelache was that time about personal things, you know, experiences, the phenomenology of lived present. I wrote something like life situations. And it was also useful in hobby projects to have festival deadlines, because then you have the deadline and it's like good for these things. And curious entertainment, not too political or something. Of course, we didn't steer away from political things, but it was not that defined thing. And this Getz has a wonderful event studies definition of event or some characterization, which is like special places, time out of time. And that's really what, if I reflect back on what Pixelache festivals meant for me and what those people and those things meant for me, it was like that. And you need the time and presence to develop something like this. And also Juha's presence is like diplomatic, like negotiation instead of argumentation. And this emotion mixed with reason, that kind of stuff. Pretty good. Yeah, but that's my thing. But it's, there would be so much to talk about and so much to, you know, somehow reflect and create new projects and something. But it's just, I don't know, things happen. Good to be here.
Petri, they were beautiful reflections. Thank you very much. It was amazing. And, you know, one day, hopefully again, we can all do this in the same physical space, right? That we don't have to do it in a Zoom room. But I think some of your reflections also make for a really nice bridge. I'm going to invite Eric to talk about his practice, his time at Pixelache, and where you're at now, Eric.
Hello. I'm in Malmö, Sweden. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes. It's really cool to see all these familiar names and faces. I did my 50% doctoral seminar yesterday, so I didn't prepare a speech.
No.
But I did collect some stuff. Let's see. It turned out to be almost like a family album. Let me just start sharing. Oh, I need to share. Can you see my screen?
We can see your screen.
Okay. It's hard to kind of overestimate the importance of Pixelache. This is, I think in 2010, it was the first time I traveled with my son. And of course I went to Pixelache. When I thought about this event this morning, it's like everywhere I turn, I see these kind of traces of Pixelache. Like, After this session, I would go to meet to a barbecue to have like a glühwein with Allison, whom I also met at Sommelina. I mean, I probably went to all Pixelaches since between 2004 and 2010, in Helsinki, in Turkey, in France, Colombia, all the different kinds of aching pixels. I was there, so it's kind of this impossible task to get a grip of this. It's like a coming of age story. So just we'll see how it goes. So just some family photos from Sommelina, and remembering all these parties. And this is from, I promise I will end in talking about something about what I'm doing now. This is in Paris. I was asked by Yua to curate an interaction design section of Malopixel. But we ended up doing a cardboard car instead. We still haven't, I don't know if we cleared the air about that yet. So a lot of the projects I did at Pixelache was together with my other partner, Magnus, in Unsworn. It's a lot about telecommunications. This was like at the same time that the rise of the iPhone. Let's skip that. So at Pixelache, what I remember is this, one thing I remember is this mix of kind of grassroots energy and a very professional organization. I don't know how you did that, but it was really an enabler. In this case, the megaphone booth, it was quite direct collaboration with the Pixelache organization to actually realize a project. Okay, this is it's a bit messy, but I'm gonna do it like this. I'm gonna say what I'm doing now, and then maybe we can talk a bit. So after doing lots of these kind of communication sound installation projects, tweaking different parameters of communication. I did this project at food, what's it called? Food cycle, which was kind of also in this Pixelache constellation event. And this was around 2014. And my since then, my gaze has turned more and more towards the non-human animals. And that's what I'm currently doing. I'm doing a PhD now on human-animal relations at KTH and Konstfack in Stockholm. So this this was what I showed yesterday. This is my PhD project. It's called A Human Design. And it's basically prototyping different ways of relating to non-human animals as a designer. And I've been doing that in three different ways so far. The ET project, the eating ET project that you saw, it's about mock meat, substituting animals, but retaining some of the qualities of eating or fishing or whatever you do. 2 years ago, I wrote a book called Designer and Goldcrest, which is about a designer who is tasked to build a kind of a visitor center about birds, and designer wants to involve the birds somehow in the process, but doesn't know how. So ventures out into the world to ask for help. How can you involve non-human stakeholders as a designer? And so it's kind of this children's story looking for something. The designer meets abolitionists who say, leave the animals alone. Post-humanist says, we are all entangled. The slaughterhouse designer who makes the lives of the animals more bearable in the end, but also makes the killing process more efficient. Anyway, this is what I'm working on now. I'm working on the ahuman angle. It's about distancing, different kind of distancing from non-human animals. So I'm working with allergies. If you're allergic, you don't have total access to other animals. And I'm working with meat allergy. It's a tick-borne allergy where you're bitten by tick, and then if you eat red meat, you get an allergic reaction. So you become physically incompatible with certain animals. I'm exploring if that could be something attractive to commit to a position, a vegan position, for example, by actually getting that allergy. And I'm also doing hypnosis sessions, if anyone's interested. If you want to quit eating meat, but find it hard to quit, it's almost like an addiction. I guess it's business as usual. Just different materials, more fleshy stuff now than in the Pixelache days. I don't know how much time I have. Maybe we can talk. Or is this a monologue?
No, I think that's perfect, Eric. We're going to go on to a couple more presentations, mm-hmm. and then what we've been doing is breaking then for open mic conversation. So
yeah, it's crazy. I still managed to mess up the time zones even after 10 years of pixelating.
Yeah, that's I think we're in confusing times. I think we're also in confusing times because everybody's got their time zones mixed up, and we're going to switch up the program just a little bit now because I know that Christina Kral has to leave earlier than we thought. So I'm wondering, Christina, whether you'd be interested to present next.
Sure, I can try. I wasn't Sorry, I was actually really confused. I didn't expect to speak. So, but it's, I'm really happy to see all of you, and some are familiar faces. Yes, brief iteration. Well, I see a few circles coming together here, because I met Juha not through Pixelache, but in 2004 for an internship. I harassed him into giving me an internship, because back then it was really hard during study to, I had to do one, and I wanted to go to Finland, I wanted to go to Helsinki, but it was really hard to get someone to take me, and Juha took me on, and then he re-invited me to be the video documenter of Pixelache for the next 4 years, I think. So I met Eric and Wojtek and Rosie, Jody Rose. You are a rose. And after I met you, actually, Amanda, in New York, because I became an artist myself, and then I started with iBeam through, where is Andrew? Yeah, Andrew, he got me there first. There you are. I supported him, and then I thought, wow, that's actually cool stuff. I want to try it myself. And so I started out with iBeam, and when Amanda was still there. And when I left New York, I actually, and here I see Oliver Kalainen, I joined Ukon in 2011, which is also back in Helsinki as part of an artist collective. And we've been together since then. And lately, to sum it up, I've been exploring solo work as a visual artist. So I kind of I went all over the place exploring, and now I'm inside a studio and trying to pursue my search, because that's something. I'm looking for things in inside a studio. So that's what I'm doing now. But it's as far as when I'm thinking about Pixelache and especially Helsinki, well, it all gets mixed up because it is so entangled. Like with Eric, I worked in Paris during the Malo Pixel. So it's kind of, for me also, it's this big blob of connection. And Amanda, that you're so close connected to Pixelache, a long time that wasn't clear to me, because we met under totally different constellations. So it's really nice that it's like so interwoven, and even looking back that there are so many connections still. So that's what I take from it. Like, this is kind of a living thing, and it manifests itself in different realities at different times. And I mean, I met Juha was it 2 years ago, where we were both standing in line to see an art in Venice. And it's just like, it keeps on connecting in some odd ways, which is beautiful to me. So this is all I have to share. If you have any questions or want to use the time in any other way, then that's fine.
No, that's lovely, Christina, to see all of those connections too. And you know, part of my connection, of course, was that I was in Helsinki working on the IZEA 2004.
That's right. I interned there too, because I wanted to be on the boat.
Or iBeam even. So yes.
It's true. It's true. Wow. See?
Mobility, but also, you know, draws attention to the research and work that Juha's doing at the moment about less travel. So in some ways, it's super interesting that we're in this space or moving again.
That's true.
I'm going to invite Ville Huvonen to speak next, if that's okay with you, Ville.
Sure, that's fine. Nice to meet you, or I mean, nice to see you all. And greetings from I'm in my studio in Katajanokka, Helsinki. Basically, I lived 10 years in Tallinn, and now been a couple of years back here. But yeah, it's I think it's kind of important note that that like me and Juha and also Petri Lievonen had like a background in this Amiga scene, which was a kind of Scandic phenomenon and still is, which started from hacker culture and software piracy, actually, originally, that people started to crack these copy protections of games and software and manifest their doings by adding these little intro programs to the games. And suddenly this actually became an art form of its own. And what was really interesting about now in retro perspective in the whole Amiga and computer scene was like that, well, you were kind of misusing the technology a little bit and using these quite primitive computers to do creative things, but also that you could be part of that phenomenon by just being a facilitator, for example, or well, you could be a coder and still have like lots of creative input, but also just keeping in contact with people or organizing these demo parties, these kind of events. That was also a really valid way. If you couldn't program or you weren't kind of artistically inclined, you could be part of it by just creating these events and keeping in contact and organizing. And this is at least my background. And I feel that this, and we already in the early 90s, I remember actually one of the first times when I was traveling abroad, it was really early in the 90s, we actually traveled to, I think, to Norway with Juha and a few other friends. We were just teenagers, and I don't know how is it so that our parents actually let us go, but there we went into to a Amiga scene demo party. And I see like a Pixelache as kind of direct continuation of that culture of creating a platform for people who don't first and foremost see themselves as an artist, but who are tinkering with the creative things, and who also benefited or benefit from a forum Petri said that when you have some sort of a deadline for your project, you have a reason to finish it and also to let it collide with the people. And I think that's, for me, has always been the or was the essence of Pixelache. And myself, I'm still kind of on the same trajectory that I've, because I was born into a theater family and spent a lot of time in the theater, but was also at the same time very interested in technology. So being in the interface, working as a, whether it's like a technical producer or sound designer, so you are in between the technology and between the creative processes on that interface. And this is where I myself feel the most comfortable being. And I think that's really where the whole Pixelache has been. And now, of course, like moving towards also like activism and like other things, but just talking from my own perspective. And but yeah, the idea that you have this group of people that you can just organize and facilitate things and gain all this knowledge. So I was already kind of working quite a lot in theater during the early days of Pixelache. And my, I guess the main forte has been to bring the technology from media art side. Basically, I've been kind of like scavenging Pixelache and bring those technologies and ideas and people to in the realms of theater, sometimes quite classical theater, but like maybe I can show some images. So that's a good, since Hilda Bridge. So screen sharing. Where are you?
The center bottom of the screen, probably.
Yeah, I see it, but it's somehow grayed out. So let me see what could cause that.
You might need host permission, I'm not sure, for the Zoom call.
Yeah, well, others have been quite successful on it, but is it something on my setup? Well, anywho.
You should have access. Everyone has.
Sure.
If you can't work it out, we can also invite you to share your screen during the next break.
Yeah, we can do that.
Might be good to log out and log back in, and might reset something. I don't know.
Hille, could it be the reason that you are already sharing your screen on your other monitor?
No, yes, it's just it's basically just the external screen. I can try to switch that off.
Yeah, now.
Let's see. Yeah, that's it actually.
Woo!
Yoo-hoo, thank you for the support. So
that's what we're here for.
Yes.
So
it used to be so, early days, it used to be so that I was the technical support. What happened? So, here are some things that I did in the National Theatre, which was basically like just one block away from Kiasma. So we did 2007, this play, classical play, but the new version of it with Mr. Christian Smets called The Unknown Soldier. And it was kind of the first major play in Finland that used the live video. And actually the video programming was made by Pauli Ojala, who I met through Pixelache. So he actually did his civil service basically civili palvelus, which means that you either go to the army or you work for some NGO. So he ended up coding for the theater simulating war. So he basically created this very nice live video system for us. So we were able to merge cinematic things and set thingies with live action. And also we're filming around in Helsinki. This was another big work called Mr. Vertigo that also did a sound and video design for the National Theatre. Really funky piece. Actually, the audience was on the stage and the stage was rotating. So it was a like immersive 360 set and sound. And actually there was also the projection mapping that this guy who now named totally, who did the mural media, Sami, something that I also knew from Pixelache, actually helped with the projection mapping, but it's, I'm sorry that I don't remember his name. And the biggest project was that I also helped to produce was called Mental Finland, that then toured the world. And that was totally based on the interactive video set, and here is a crucified Santa Claus played by Kalle Holmberg, and also with live video narratives. And then the Cherry Orchard 2009 in Lithuania was kind of like a live documentary theater happening that was then also became a documentary film and was live streamed to different theater festivals. So there was also did the design and worked as a technical lead. But so you could kind of say that the whole Pixelache thing has been really kind of essential for my whole, like, so to say, career. And I've been kind of continuing doing things with the same ethos, or at least trying. And also I was, I think, a couple of 3 or 4 years in Kiasma, we were also having this seminar called Video in Theatre, where we actually gathered all these people who were interested on the topic to discuss, and which actually reminds me that it's a pity that we are missing few faces from here who were really important. We are missing Jenni Valorinta and Aura Seikkula and Minna, who were really important in the beginning, and also Natalie Ombre, who was our coordinator and producer. So because I was also, like, as one of the organizers, I was really proud that we actually had some sort of like gender balance quite in the early stages of the festival when it came to organizers and also the participants, which was quite different, especially coming from the Amiga computer scene, which was really, really male. Anywho, after this 15 years of really intensely doing this technical and video sound design for the theater and opera, I now have worked for 8 years in cinema. So I started a company that was also very inspired by my experience with the Pixelache. This is the company called Helicam, which is basically flying drones for movies and TV, and these kind of quite large drones. So from the very beginning, I was really willing to go for the really kind of high end and work with the cinema cameras. But also, we didn't have drones that were big enough, so we ended up designing. This is our own little modular design. So this Helicam has really taken me around the world and back. And it's been a really similar project. So it's been really lots of DIY, lots of tinkering and CNC mills and printers. But at the same time, my kind of benefit there has been that I've been also able to talk shop with artists and cinematographers and so to say. So being there also interfacing technology and creativity, yeah, has been kind of the thing. But yeah, now the past couple of years, I've been a bit like dialing down on the drone front, as it's not so avant-garde anymore, and it started to feel like work, you know. So now I'm back doing more music and sound work and technical production. And actually, I could still show from here. This is actually image from Pixelache 2004. This was a project called The Gray Zone, done with the art collective CNCD that also Juha Huuskonen was a part originally when it was a Amiga demo group. And actually we did actually our first album 1995, then another album 2000, and then we had 2004 and 2005 these gigs organized with Pixelache. And actually today is the funny day that we released our first album in 20 years actually with the same group. So the past 5 years we've been working with the group of 5 people that we've been known since the 90s from this demo group that Juha was also part. So here I'm holding the vinyl album that just came out today. So that was my pitch. You should now all go to buy the album so we can make our money back. No, but yeah, so that's kind of like in a really rambling manner, I guess, telling where I am currently and how my current and past has totally been entangled with all the pixels. I myself stepped down from being the chairman, like, I think 5 years ago now, or something like this. when I started to feel that the organization and the kind of the people around it were going to a bit different direction that I was, and instead of trying to kind of fight it, I thought that okay, it's I've been there already for such a long time, so it's time to let other people do it. But yeah, I think that's basically it.
Venla, that was a fabulous rambling kind of expose into at the moment. It's fantastic and wonderful to see that the kind of hacker culture and the tinkering has continued to influence so much of your work. I'm going to pass the mic, I think, to Ulla Taipale, if that's all right with you, Ulla. And then we'll take another micro break and have a kind of open mic moment. Is that all right with people? Ulla, you right?
Hello, everybody. Can you hear me? Yes?
Yes, you will.
It's really nice to see everybody. And thanks for these wonderful presentations. The more I hear, I think the more confused I get. I mean, with my presentation, that it's kind of like getting influenced with by all these kind of declarations of the people that we know since a long time, and yeah, thanks for Andrew and Steve for facilitating. And I think this is an idea of Andrew, this wonderful way to get in touch. Touch again with people. I'm talking from Barcelona, and actually why I got involved with Pixelache was that in 2008 there was a total solar eclipse happening in the world, and this the zone of the total solar eclipse coincided with a big part of the Russia and China. And I had this idea as a curator to make a project during the total solar eclipse. And I started making this project that later got name Curated Expeditions of Capsula. And it was a really tight timetable because I have this date, and it's one of these very few dates in the world that you can't change, postpone or anything. It was the 1st of August in 2008, and I found this collaboration with the zoological park in Novosibirsk in Russia. And what I wanted to do was to invite artists to work with the topic of the animal reaction during the total solar eclipse. So and yeah, this is a long story and everything, but this expedition was done with three wonderful artists: Agnes Maya Brandis, Mireia Saladriguez from Catalonia, Agnes is German, and Tommy Taipale from Finland. And the two topics or important things during the expeditions was to study some natural phenomenon through artistic means, and the slow travel. And now, meanwhile, Juha was giving her presentation. Somehow I also understood why he got interested in this project later on. Because to Siberia, we traveled using the Trans-Siberian train connection, and actually Tommy Taipale was hitchhiking and using bicycles to go to back to Siberia. And then during these 2 minutes and 20 seconds that was the eclipse there, all the artists were doing their works. And then after that, I was living there in Barcelona as well, but I was very disconnected of the cultural scene in Helsinki. And I made this kind of like a round. I contacted with people in Helsinki that I found interesting, and Pixelache was one of these. And I met Juha, And we had this wonderful meeting with Natalie and Johan, and they, after that, they invited the project to be part of the Pixelache 2009. And we made an exhibition to Mediatek of Kiasma. And I have, well, I have no slides, but I have some images. This is an eclipse. It's a NASA released these postcards that is, it's a, well, you can't see it very well, but pew, this camera doesn't take it. But anyway, this is the eclipse. And here are the different works that, oh shit, can you?
Because you're using the green screen that we can't see it so well.
Okay, but anyway, there is Agnes Meyer Brandis working with the moon geese in Ireland in Ob River. Then Mireia Saladriguez experimenting with animal reaction during the eclipse in a zoological park. And then Tommy Taipale, who made this travel. Well, I don't show this because you can't see them. And what comes to the, well, then after this exhibition that was done in Kiasma, we also made another event. It was called Eclipse Happening in Observatory there in Kaivopuisto with some geese and everything. Then after that, I collaborated with Pixelache with many, many years, and it has been wonderful. I met incredible people, and I think my practice as a curator and creator has been very much influenced because of this great network of people. And something of the kind of since 2009, I think until 2000, I don't remember, maybe now we are in 20, maybe 2015, I've been very involved and part of the chair many years as well, part of the board many years. I think something very characteristic with the work with Pixelache was many years the kind of like the feeling that anything that you propose, it's very welcome. I mean, you could propose any wild things and nobody was saying that, yeah, you are crazy, we can't do that. Anything was considered, and that's why we made such a great things and Pixelache still continues, because I think all kind of peoples and all kind of ideas are welcome. And I remember one topic that was all the time repeating in the board discussions every year. We had this doubt, was the festival, Pixelache Festival, two insider event, and if anybody understood what is Pixelache, and this kind of like this question repeated year after year, I think this was one of the big characteristic of Pixelache people and the festival and everything, that we couldn't even ourselves define what is Pixelache. So and going forward with this this Kiasma topic, then Andrew proposed this idea of making a longer project under the name Herpologies Foraging Networks. That was, correct me, Andrew, if I'm wrong, from 2010. And this was also very much based in Kiasma. We made a hydroponic installation there that was growing a couple of months in the hall of Kiasma, Also, there was Adam Saratsky, an American bioartist, who made a DNA extraction workshop in Kiasma. And was there other things in Kiasma as well? I don't remember. Signe Pusena organized the moonshine workshop that we were a bit worried if this can be done, but Juha, brave man, took the responsibility on him if the moonshine, then moonshine was named in other ways, so it was more legal to do it. But this was the 2010 in Kiasma as well. And what else I wanted to say? So, well, if I very shortly explain what I'm doing at the moment, I'm still working combining the arts with natural sciences, nature, natural phenomenon, and ecology. And my principal job at the moment is in University of Helsinki, in a department called INAR, that is an institute of for atmospheric and earth system research, where I work as a curator. It's the base of climate world, that is the arts program that I'm leading or curating is in a forestry field station in Hyytiala, that it's between Tampere and Mänttä. And this is a place that a very important climatic studies and research is done. It's forest ecology and earth and atmospheric studies. And they have been very welcoming also for artists to work there. And now this year has been a bit disappointment in a sense that there were a lot of interesting things going to happen, but now it has been a slow and silent. And but anyway, we had a last year open call for a project for artists in residence. But I would like to encourage everybody to be in contact if you are interested in these topics. The research related with boreal forests, peatlands, and atmospheric studies, to just to be in contact. And it's not just what is kind of, if there is a call going on, there is a possibility to be in contact with the scientists who are working with these topics and so. And we tried this next year also to start again doing workshops for different people who want to work, combine arts with these research topics. And what else? I'm working also in a project called the Conference of the Birds. That's an initiative by Eva Bakkelslett, a Norwegian artist and curator. And there is a project called Corus Sinensis that I'm working with Finnish artist, Launau, musician, Jan Eerala, who is a photographer, and Karolina Lumma, Finnish scholar specialized in bird poetry. We are creating an audiovisual piece for choir that is related to merimetso, that are great cormorants. They are like wolves or Canada geese in Finland. They are very hated bird species. And this is a work that will be presented in Pori Art Museum in 22. So this is something that I'm working at the moment as well. And then other project that is a long-term project that also started with the connection made during a Pixelache events with Christina Stadelbauer, Meli Ferropolis, that is honeybees and pollinators in urban context. It kind of like is an ongoing project, but we can't be so active that in earlier days, but this is also going on still. And what else? I can put in a chat some links if for these projects, if anybody's interested.
We'd love to see links to those projects, Ulla, that's fantastic. But I am going to ask us to maybe go to a break now. Open mic, everybody can have a chat, but just 5 minutes this time, and we'll be back here at in 5 minutes for Sophia's presentation. But we'd love to see those links, Ulla, that would be amazing.
Okay, I'll put that in the break. Thanks. It's
so nice to hear what you're up to.
Just a question for Ville, if she's still there.
Ville.
About the new album.
Yes.
Yeah, is that demo scene as well, or is it like with modern stuff, or is it done with Amigas?
Sorry, I'm just swallowing a carrot. So yeah, it's with the same group, but it's kind of experimental soundscape, field recording, ambient. So not with Amigas.
Okay. Cool.
But yeah, I can. I'm happy to send a link.
Yeah, please do.
Great. And Vishnu, didn't you want the mic for a moment?
Oh, thank you for checking in. No, I just wanted to say when I heard Petri Levonen's, how was it, creative misuse of technology, I thought about glitch feminism, and then I was connecting also to Tuomo's DMX, where I have been tinkering quite much, and it's they were parallels, and I wanted to make this comment. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of bit feminism too. I think she's a really super awesome author.
So I could briefly comment Petri's talk as well, if that's okay.
Yeah, please.
So I just in general wanted to thank Petri for the reflections, because I think I think there's a lot of important sort of questions or starting points there, and at least in terms of what is the sort of this situation or a platform where things can emerge and where things can happen. I think it's a question that is now kind of urgent in the university world, because the university world has been, there has been these big shifts. And there's this one, I'll paste the link here, there is this article by Anne Hjort Guttu from Oslo. The article, it's the end of the art education as we know it. So it's an article about in how in Nordic countries the art universities have become more bureaucratic, and then there's less room to actually learn or do anything. and then I've had a chance to be in touch with Anne a bit, because there is this informal kind of group of people sort of somehow supporting this initiative in Rojava. They are setting up this Rojava University at the moment, and they have a quite this tabula rasa situation there. They don't have much resources, because Rojava itself is not sort of recognized as a state that much currently. So, but anyway, I think these are sort of important, super important questions, and I think something that would be somehow super valuable to reflect on, and it's kind of, I think it's difficult to get back to that era, but there was this, in the early days of Pixelache, this whole idea of what these communication tools are for, like what is the nature of these tools. I mean, we were using etherpads and wikis and etc. And email lists and so on. So then when Facebook and these other sort of, which are now the dominant social media tools, when they arrived, that was at least to me personally, it was quite a shock that, okay, is this the way this is going to happen? Because the whole, like the logic and the ethos was so different than what I would imagine the future to be. And I think that's still a very pertinent question. I mean, in terms of the way things are going with Facebook and other platforms, it's not going well. So I think there still would be work to do in that domain.
Yes, I think there's several issues that you've raised there, Juha, that I think are really important for our futures. This is something that we discuss a lot here in the teaching that I do, is like, what are social media platforms, especially for younger people, and what do they mean in any sort of way? But the other thing is, here in America too, that there's actually a kind of a new movement. There's a number of kind of artist-run art schools that are emerging because of the bureaucratic nature of where tertiary education goes here, which is also in America, it's incredibly expensive, like outrageously expensive. So there is quite a movement of artist-led art schools. But what are the new social platforms? So maybe we're ready to go into our next round of presentation.
Sorry, I just wanted to make one more comment. It's more a question. I don't know if people are actually reading their chats, but I had a question for Ulla, because I'm very... I know of Ava Bakaslet's work as well. And I was thinking about if there is like some kind of a connection making with real eco observations to some kind of esoteric practices. And I'm thinking also of the apps like CoStar, which are giving like astrological predictions. And I came upon this article which has been finding more and more evidence on like astrological predictions and birds' migrational patterns. And then another app which is also the pattern. So it's more like a question also, because I'm curious if there are some kind of like departing from or like using esoteric practices. And then I forget one more question was like this hypnosis, the working of hypnosis. Someone was asking in terms of presenting in terms of meat eating and hypnosis.
That was Eric.
Are they here?
Yeah,
I would like to know a bit more about this.
Well, if I first answer from here to your question, I don't know this app, the pattern, neither other astrological predictions. I think I have been more into astronomical phenomenon, but this is something that maybe is interesting to look at, yeah, no, this has not been so much in my scope.
Thank you.
About the hypnosis, I can post a link in the chat to something, some more info.
Thank you very much, Eric. Yeah, please do post links in. And actually, Ulla, you direct. You sent your links directly to me, but I'm happy to share them with the whole group.
Ah, okay. There, I thought that I sent them for everybody.
Not a problem.
I have a question for Eric. Does the vegan hypnosis, does it work if you're like a really bad vegetarian? Like, does it help you to become a better vegetarian?
If you need to be motivated.
I'm definitely motivated.
Yeah, that's let's talk.
Okay, cool.
I'm preparing a Zoom hypno script.
Awesome.
Fantastic.
Thank you, Eric. But now I'm going to hand the mic to Sophia, if that's possible. Lovely to see your face, Sophia.
Hi, lovely to see so many faces. I'm really excited to see the band back together. For me, returning recently-ish to Finland on the brink of COVID, getting settled back in here, I've found myself being very attached to very local projects in other places. And I'm just going to talk through some broad brushstrokes around those things that I've been working on and how I ended up almost back where I started. I'll just get some screen sharing happening here. So, can everybody see? Some of you will remember the epic radio project that that I instigated in Pixelache in 2005 with the lovely Jody Rose on board as producer, Arnie Radio, and there was a lot of food and eating action around that and other iterations of the Arnie Radio project in Helsinki. And I ended up moving to Delhi where versions of that kind of activity continued. But the core project for me that kept me there for a long time was Delhi Listening Group, which emerged out of collaborations with Encore via Sarai, Encore Society for Alternatives in Education was the partner project in this ongoing, now more than 10 years collaboration. So a research collective sort of combining socially engaged listening and participatory educational practices as a way of understanding a city that was really in a big state of upheaval and where the lived city and the master plan were not the same, telling the same story at all. The kind of key factors in a lot of our projects were this sort of sense of relationships that are built up slowly over time and technology that can be very improvised and come together very quickly. And the concept of jugga expresses that latter thing in Hindi, but I think there's a lot of crossovers with the DIY and hacker aesthetics that emerged there. This project was super local, grounded in marginalized communities around New Delhi and involving an extended group of up to 16 different practitioners at various times. There's still a core group continuing with this, and at the moment we're really working to bring together a book of texts and documentation from these projects. I won't dive into too much detail there, but I'll post some links after. The sort of 10 years arc of this sort of rounded up with the here's a project that I did did in 2006 around the demolition of a community called Nangamachi, where one of the Sarai Sabamhala labs was placed, where I'd been doing some workshops. And then in 2016, we did a project in Savdogovo, one of the resettlement colonies, where a lot of displaced people had been moved from the demolitions that had been part of the violent beautification of the city for the Commonwealth Games, were relocated. And we took some of these bricks that we'd taken from the original site, and people brought together objects that they had from their original neighbourhoods. And we involved the young women's writing group to sort of tell the stories of those objects and those transitions, and to really celebrate that in 10 years, houses, shops, schools, bus stops, things had come up in the new locality. So yeah, that's a very long-term grounded in local communities project, but we're trying to find a way to sort of bring all that stuff together into a book so we can share it with a wider context and not just the audiences in the localities. I then went on to spend some time in Sydney doing some live broadcast projects for the ABC in their briefly lived audio, creative audio unit that popped up before government cuts took it down again, and playing tape machines in the long-standing loop orchestra. But the project that really kept my feet on the ground there before moving back to Finland was Front Yard, where we call the board janitors because we're very hands-on. So I've been a janitor at Front Yard for a few years now, and it's not just artist run space, and my involvement there, there's a project I did about compost and exoelectrogenic bacteria there last year, but a lot of my kind of engagement around Front Yard has been around the garden, the backyard at Front Yard, as over, like since about 2010, I've been increasingly excited about working with local food system engagement, particularly in cities and particularly in megacities. So, yeah, that's a out of control sweet potato patch. Also, spent a lot of time helping develop the digital space, which in the COVID situation and as a remote janitor, I found to be like, it was good we had that. But most recently, I've been getting off the ground this project that was a long time brewing. It's a collaboration with Kaushub Srikant, who's now in Berlin. And the lockdowns brought a flood of people to us asking for help with doing live remote stuff and streaming. And we'd been brewing this project for a while, so we've just kind of got it off the ground. It's very new. But in a way, it's like coming back around to where we were with Annie Radio. It was a lot of the underlying streaming technologies are the same, but it's a very different context now. As Yuha was saying, we're kind of like super motivated by trying to provide an alternative to the to Facebook Live and those kind of platforms, and to sort of support diversity of expression in the open web. So yeah, same technology, very different context. So this is a platform that's supporting independently produced open content audio, and hopefully we'll be able to launch the channel. We've got a few events coming up, but we'll hopefully be able to launch the channel properly in the next few months. And I'm currently getting stuck into some speculative design and communication projects around food systems, and hoping to set lunch free sometime around the middle of next year. So that's the sort of broad brushstrokes of what's front and center in my radar at the moment. And it's funny having this opportunity now to see how the more things change, the more they stay the same in so many ways. Thank you.
That was a lovely loop around of going back to move forward. And I love the fact that so many of us are working on things around open food systems and also rethinking what open communication platforms might look like. Thank you very much, Sophia. I'm now going to call on Tuomo Tamanpa.
Hello.
Struggling to unshare my screen. I've lost access to the controls. Oh, here we go.
Cool. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, Tuomo.
Good. Yep. So nice to see so many old friends and new friends here. Excellent. Fantastic. Thank you for Amanda for facilitating Steve and Andrew to setting it up. So yeah, my name is Tuomo. I know most of you, I think. I was more active in the early years of Pixelache, but still member and done these kind of remote participatory thingies with Pixelache. I don't have any presentation. I keep it very short. So. Just some reflection more about why Pixelache's been so important to me rather than what I've been doing lately. That's easier to share with links. So kind of Pixelache, or just before Pixelache, that was kind of late 90s and was start of my professional career or work as a kind of a media artist and mostly the designer. So and managed to keep the balance still quite nicely going. So there's a part of life is design, part is artistic, like or kind of more self-organizing work without kind of paying client. But met with Juha early days of internet and especially graphical internet with Catastrophe, and and reflecting a little bit of Ville's kind of points to the early years also. That was the kind of the very exciting new times in terms of kind of a technology and art and Pixelache. First Catastrophe with a little bit more kind of demo scene attitude, and then Pixelache grew out into this very interestingly artistic approach to it. And as Ulla mentioned, like a very kept this very kind of open-minded. There's no limit in that sense, that everything is kind of can be proposed and discussed. So there's the categorization was very very flexible and in my mind has kept so. What I was involved why it's important in the early years was because it was also the time of this DIY electronics make kind of a. Learn yourself, workshop culture, all these that have been managed to kind of keep going ever since. And it was very, emphasis was in very creative and artistic use. There was a very, this was just pre-maker culture. The term wasn't really used at that time. There wasn't YouTube in their early years. There wasn't, platforms like Arduino. We were kind of really experimenting on the electronics and the creativity with it, and the sharing platform was where places like Pixelache and obviously internet, but less so in the early years. And this open hardware and thinking with your hands and sharing while you are learning and doing that's been fundamental for my work ever since, and many other colleagues, and they all kind of collided into the the annual Pixelache definitely in even more frequently when there was a kind of exhibitions and touring shows in connecting all those many same people over those years. So kind of the open hardware sharing workshop culture, that's been the kind of the thing that has I've kind of learned it through Pixelache, obviously through all the kind of networking and the what how we met all the fantastic projects and people and so that's basically foundation still on my work and that wouldn't be there without Pixelache. And as many like the most important kind of collaborations I do nowadays, they many of them link to Pixelache. So Dan Blackburn, who is now living in Finland, in the same island as I'm, we had the tile toy and some early electronics project back in the early days. Ville, obviously, I've been working, still working, and there's been very intensive part. So that was kind of started from Pixelache time. Jürgen Neumann, Ohanda Open Hardware project that now is turned to something very interesting. I hope we can share something that very soon. That's also part of the Pixelache history. So there was basically kind of my professional 70% of the stuff I do today is there's a link to Pixelache. So, but most importantly, I would say that the kind of the sharing, the workshopology, the type of kind of getting messy, really like hold the kitchen as a laboratory and everything that kind of Andrew and Ulla has done and the kind of the bio food organic approaches to this very strangely named festival called Pixelache. So the kind of the Pixelache disappeared pretty quickly from the kind of the early years, which is fantastic dynamic thing in my mind. So and lately just this year we have this culture stew. I've been traveling to Taiwan a few years now, and that started with Pixelache because Andrew invited SR Chai from Dimension Plus to Pixelache, and we hooked up, and I've been working every year in Taiwan since then. So I have a massive kind of a respect for all these networking opportunities and learning outcomes for doing by sharing. So that's my wrap.
That's a perfect wrap, Formal. Learning by sharing, learning by doing. That's awesome. Thank you so much, Formal. Katikia, can I call on you to present next?
Thank you, Amanda. And hello, everyone. It's great to see all of y'all, or at least in avatars, as names even. Yeah, it's been, To start, when Andrew asked me, there was a question, when was it that you were involved in Pixelache? For me, I just reflected back on that. So it started in 2005, and 2004 when Yuha came to India for use in India for Doors Festival at Doors 9. That was when I met Yuha, and then next year I was there for Pixelache with a project called Used in India with Aditya. And then the latest Pixelache that I have kind of participated in or in some form was in 2016. So that's, and then now it's today and in 2020, it's, we are watching each other on the screen. So for me, it's I find it very interesting and also intriguing that, from the Kiasma days when like a kind of an institutional structure, like as a museum or as a contemporary art museum there, and then it moving into more, distributed and dissipated form into the city and into smaller places in Kallio. I'm just talking about, say, after 2010. I also was part of the network then, and I participated. And then now onto just the screen, So that's, I see that kind of, transformation. And I'm just it just makes me think that how things have evolved. And by the way, I'm currently based in Denmark. So it's been, you know, from India to Finland and then now to Denmark. You know, that part has been quite, I mean, it's quite a journey just be part of this community. And I think other than the 2005 Pixelache that I was part of, and then 2008, when I came again as an artist, and then, you know, I started living in Finland after 2010. And then in 2012, it was, I think, one of when Pixelache had, you know, transformed into the more distributed format. And then there was the alternative design capital. And then we got, we were part of the network and Pixelache through something that we all did, or a group of us did, called Talking Trash Lab, which, you know, became the repair cafes, and it evolved into that. And then currently I'm building on that, and based in Aarhus University, we are, you know, trying on a research proposal working on repairability. So these are, you know, kinds of small seeds that, you know, the working with others and, you know, building from the group of people that have been so closely involved. I mean, this is a kind of the red line that I can draw. And I don't have any presentations. I just thought I will just speak about my reflection. And then, so I think there are some good things that were, you know, that have come out from being part of the community. And then, of course, I also take this opportunity to kind of reflect on some of the people involved, and in particularly relating to, you know, authorship and responsibility. I think one of the Pixelaches was about do it with others. There was the Devo theme. And there have been some issues and concerns with the current Finnish, you know, artists, you know, particularly media artists. There have been certain unfortunate things, and I just think that, you know, it was my responsibility to bring this thing up, because the people involved were are part of the Pixelache network, and I'm not going to, you know, dwell more on this. But there are issues, and then I think the community needs to discuss this part, and as group of people who have been working with others, and particularly relating to authorship and responsibility. So with that, I would just say that I really enjoy being part of the network. It has given me friends, and I am still part of, you know, I still talk to people that I spoke to in 2005. And then I build up on the ideas and the network largely. And also, you know, these kinds of long reflections of 15 years, that's, yeah. Thanks, and it's lovely just meeting and talking to all of you earlier.
Awesome, fantastic to hear your reflections, Katika. Kevin, I think you're up next, is that right?
Yes.
Beautiful.
Yeah, let me...
Thank you.
Okay, so yeah, I think there is a video. Do you hear me well? Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so hello everyone. Nice to see you all. It's strange. It's like we change worlds. Two times. First time with the COVID, and now with the nostalgia. It's a bit okay. It's a bit strange because still. Okay. Well, I'm not also very prepared. I have nothing really like nothing to show specifically. Like I was more like expecting to hear about anyone for trajectories and thinking. I guess maybe this is a bit of sharing and going a bit like dynamically. So. So I'm now in Paris in this like right now it's a second lockdown here, and I'm very happy actually there was this meeting. I'm a bit surprised it happens on Zoom, but anyway, what is not on Zoom at the moment. So, and yeah, well, I was also like listening to. So I was a bit late due to my organization, quite bad organized, but I jump after a moment listening to a lot of things, and it was like, okay. I love when Ville said like misusing technologies. I think it was maybe like for me, like a group of people misusing things. I think also like there was this mention of, any idea is welcome. Any idea is welcome. And yeah, it's true, like the weirdest ideas were welcome. I mean, like I have good memories of really crazy, uncanny, uncommon, unexpected, bizarre ideas and projects. And I think like this is like one of the quality of this festival. We were always surprised by the proposition, and there was this kind of. As they say in the sign language, an emulation. There were so many things to say. Like we met with you like in Paris. I don't know, like a few months ago. I think it was just before the lockdown. Something about like February or March. I'm not really sure now. The world changed so fast since then. So, yeah, and also like I was also with the OMF, so I think it was also like an important part, like all this collaboration, this circulation of ideas, of people, of groups, of projects. I was with them like in Indonesia, like. The whole group, like Venza, the ONF, like the few folk stuff here, the life patch, so also Acteria there. So yeah, the people they are still there. Like I mean, like the spirit of the thing is still there, and the group is still around. I mean, like I think there was always this problematic of the name. I remember like the Malo Pixel and the Pixel Festival, and everybody was like, what should we do with the Rixi? Are they part of the network? They have not the same name, etc., etc. But actually, like, I mean, despite like, despite the names, like the things are still there. So I'm very happy, like, just to be there. Continue to misuse a little bit the technologies. I don't know, I hope we can, I don't know, have the chance to meet physically, either in Paris or somewhere else, as soon as we can escape from Zoom. So, okay, so just hello everyone. Nice to see you all. I'm very happy to listen to all your experiences and stuff. And yeah, let's discuss together. Bye.
Thank you so much, Aaron. It was great to hear your presentations and your reflections. We're now going to take another 10-minute break, open mic, have a conversation with one another before we head into our final set of presentations. So, 10 minutes.
So, there is some kind of a system line here now. Sorry, I was away for some time, just got back.
That's okay. A
lot of new faces.
There's new faces, there's been some change over. Some people have arrived and some have left. It's actually been lovely to see the kind of rollover of different people able to drop in.
Share
a coffee or on Glöggy by now, I would have thought.
Yeah, kind of a pikkujoulu feeling.
Exactly.
I was driving and actually watching in traffic lights from the Facebook feed. Not yeah. While driving, though. But...
Hey, Toby, I might ask you to kick off the next session if you're up for that.
Yeah, I can do this because I'm... I actually do have 12 minutes. I'm like, somehow my day got so busy. I was thinking to hang out here, also drink a little bit, but... Yeah. But hey...
Everybody's got glurgy happening here.
Yeah, so yes, I was I think it was in 2007 when I was in actually performing in Pixelache. But of course, I've been as I live in Tallinn, it's really close by, so I've been attending the festival like before as well. And on that year, we had a nice performance together with one Estonian musicians. Me and my friend, we were doing in this Kiasma cinema hall, like an audiovisual concert. We were young and very proud about this on that time. And of course, like the Pixelache has always been, like I'm always checking what is happening. And a lot of friends from that time. And also now I see like a lot of new friends are also old Pixelache heroes, like Tuomo is there, I can see. And and Ville was here. And, but yeah, it's right now I'm still so like a media artist, mostly working with visual based stuff, with doing like video mappings and animations for mostly for like theater projects and museums. This year it's been quite a lot of ballet themed. I've had two ballet premieres. Quite fun ones, one for kids, but it's always a very nice gig to have, especially in theater. So you can, like an adult audience, you know, they can always say like, oh, it was very nice and we enjoyed it. But maybe inside it was not so cool. But with kids, you can already see like if in theater, if there is a silence in the audience side, so definitely kids enjoy the play. So it's a very nice thing. Maybe I can also, I don't know, would be nice maybe to share a screen a bit, because I didn't prepare as a proper presentation as that, but I can show quickly some things. I don't know, is my screen shared now?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. You see, oh yeah, this is like one of the ballet thing plays called Golden Temple, which we had a premiere on 1st of December. It was actually supposed to be premiered in spring, but exactly one day before all the corona or COVID restrictions hit, so we were cancelled. And we had it in this National Estonian Opera House. Like now it's 10 days ago, I think. So this is kind of visual things, what I'm working right now. And also another nice project, what was what I'm working right now, what was supposed to happen on Sunday, but of course was canceled to the new restrictions what hit Estonia. So we were, everything was like is closed down since like tomorrow. So it was like kind of again, close to the deadline. Big like kind of a video mapping thing together with my students. So I'm teaching in an art university in Tallinn. And they were supposed to have like a big show for student work and also my work on this amazing facade. And you can also see that there is this kind of a post, it's post-Soviet building. So, and you see this magnificent memory of this these times. But it actually, I think it turned out fine because I have a new workshop with in next year, and this mapping now was postponed to February, probably end of February, so more students can be part of this. So it's always nice to have like a real life project, and then this everybody probably knows that like renting out this big projectors and sound systems, it's quite expensive. So it's nice that I can kind of mix my work and the teachings, so the students can have like a real life experience as well. Otherwise, it's I don't know, like quite a lot of work. So, and of course, doing more sound things. We have a nice release from Casino Records in summer when we were like jamming together in Ville with Villa and some other people. So, it's feeling completely unprepared for all this. And this is sort of like a couple of years of work, but I have to say like I've been also quite bad with updating my web portfolio, so it's less than half of the
Here's projects. The cassettes.
Yeah, where is you? Oh, Villa, yeah, this is a nice cassette. So I think this is more or less what I've been doing. Also like the back visual is a theater play what was supposed to happen in spring. It's a Canadian production about this Polish writer Kosinski, if you maybe know, quite kind of a scandal writer dude. But of course like a lot of projects in my work are being cancelled because they're like audience involved, and so but it's like everything is still going, so I think I'm feeling quite optimistic about all this. And actually I think I've been even enjoying, maybe I think it's of course very bad, and you know, all this disease and stuff, but it's also brought out many different social aspects in our societies and see how people react to this. And so it's been very interesting in that sense. But and I guess that's it.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Tarvi.
Yeah.
I'm next going to call on Melinda Sipas, if you'd like to share your reflections.
Yes, thank you. Hi, everyone. Lots of familiar and not familiar faces. So I must admit that I didn't, I haven't prepared anything coherent or a presentation. Also because my week was very heavy. My sister got into a car accident and now she's well, but I spent a few days with her. So I will just tell you some thoughts of what came into my mind since I was invited to this meeting, and also while I was listening to you, which was really interesting. Maybe the first thing was when someone told that that Pixelache at the Pixelache team, it was so important to be not too coherent and too nice and too corporate. And I think my how I joined Pixelache Festival was exactly this ambivalent case, because I was there on behalf of Kitchen Budapest, which was a media lab founded by the Hungarian telecom company. So everyone there looked at us. We were the suspicious ones, like all this big crew from this this telecom powered lab. But I think we were great guys, geeks and artists and creators and designers, and we were, I think, super happy to get invited and to show our works. And for me, it was really like not a turning point, but certainly a reference point, and still is actually. So I met so many people. I have been in touch so far. Some of them became friends. I started this art and technology, or I got into this art and technology scene around my studies at Paris, and then in 2006. So Pixelache was really one of the first so-called professional experience for me. And even though now I do things which are less related to art and technology, I mean, in my work, but it is still a reference point. Like, I always check what Pixelache does, the people I met there. And also there are so many things which remained with me in my work. For example, when I participated a data cuisine workshop with Nathalie Aubrey, we were in a team together in 2012, which was also somehow around Pixelache, even though not during the festival, but a very special and very curious event and a very special initiative playing around with food and data, for example. So what my experience with Pixelache was always this kind of like very new, very experimental. And I think maybe it's also your experience as well. What else I wanted to say? I had so many thoughts, especially while listening to you, but there were the main points. Yeah, so maybe a little bit about me, because I think most of you are, you don't know me. I'm a designer, and I was involved in the art and technology circles around like between 2007 and 13, I think, mostly. And since this time, I have done so many different things. Years I was I was closer to like social design. I even founded a design brand, a design company in Budapest. Oh, I'm based in Budapest, by the way. But also I experimented a lot and did research in special or interesting areas in food culture. And then I got two children. So the first one was born in 2014. So since 2014, things slowed down a little bit. And I also started a PhD. Actually, my first topic was around artistic collaborations, which was also inspired by this whole Pixelache experience and the Kitchen Budapest experience, where all these diverse people work together. But then now I switched to data visualization, because this is my current interest. So I mostly do things, installations that are based on some kind of data, so physical things. And what remained with me from this art and tech scene was that I'm teaching kids, and I'm tinkering with kids from age 6 to 14, 16, actually, quite on a regular basis. So this is really cool. And I try to keep it low tech and combine all the very old school stuff with some new technologies, like like microbits and so on. So I try to bring in this geek spirit, which is actually not easy in their circles. Things which are not working is not a easy to accept. So I try to make them understand that tinkering and failing and repairing all the stuff they do is part of the journey. Yeah, I think I can finish it here.
Thank you for your reflections, Melinda. That was really lovely. Wojtek, can I call on you to
thank you
say your reflections next?
Hi there.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you well.
Perfect. Yeah, so this is quite challenging part. So I didn't prepare any presentations because this is too big to squeeze into a presentation. I mean, Pixelache has been so much part of my life, has been so much like integral to it and part of really shaping me as a person and as an artist, as an educator, as an activist. I mean, I met Juha when I was 23 in 2003 in Helsinki. I was studying in a school that doesn't even in a kind. I think it was like not university, but almost. Kind of, I was studying graphic design, and that school doesn't even exist anymore. and I met Juha, and he because he made a presentation about Pixelache actually, and the stuff that they started to do, and the festival they were preparing. And after the presentation, I came up to him and asked, like, "Do you need any help?" And after this came many sleepless nights and trying to edit videos for the festival and then making graphic design and then being involved in the production and then also as an artist and presenting stuff and all sorts of things. Like I think I have participated in all the Pixelaches in Helsinki since then, being involved in each of them in one way or another. So it's really like a broad, I mean, and there are like a lot of influential people that, because I was quite young, only 23 when I met the Pixelache crowd. So, that really made me, helped me think about my own activities and careers and interests in a much more, open and unstructured, maybe way more free. So I got after this, like about 10 years ago, no more now, like 12 years ago, I returned to Poland. I was living quite long in Finland, 10 years, but then I returned to Poland and this was part of Pixelache also that I got much more involved in these political and social issues and trying to blend that with artistic practice. So I was doing activist work and started teaching and both Juha Huskonen and later Andrew Patterson were a big influence in this shaping of my interests. I was involved in projects like what was the name? Herbologies and Foraging Networks and going to trips with Pixelache to different places, to Paris, to Sweden, to Latvia, to Lithuania, to Estonia. So it's been really a long story with Pixelache for me, and I'm still, even though I'm not living there since 12 years, I'm still in contact every year when there's a festival happening, I'm there to participate, and I've been doing a little bit of graphic design also also this year for Pixelache. I just wanted to share with you maybe.
So what are you up to now, Wojciech?
Okay, so maybe, yeah, enough of the veteran stuff. And because there's too much to say about this, and I might get nostalgic, and we really don't want to go in that direction. So actually, this kind of happened in parallel with Pixelache and sparking my interest in thinking critically about politics, society, and the environment. I remember in 2003, Juha Huuskonen lent me the book of Naomi Klein, No Logo, and that was really like, I remember that being an eye-opener for me, because I was just a graphic design student and wanted to later to work in some agency doing graphic design. But after I came across with Pixelache, nothing was the same anymore. And then after this, when I came back to Poland, I got really involved in activist work. And since 10 years, I've been strongly involved in shaping the food cooperative scene here in Poland. I've been co-founding the first kind of grassroots food cooperatives here in Poland, and I've been like really advocate of this movement since more than 10 years now, and also working a lot with degrowth. With the degrowth movement, and recently as well with food sovereignty. Well, recently, since 4 years now, it's like the time span is a little bit confusing. So, and my main activities are around education. So I do a lot of like facilitation work and prepare workshops, educational materials, and about cooperatives, about food sovereignty, about social solidarity economy, and all sorts of things connected to that. And I'm doing workshops, designing workshops, designing and producing educational materials for these workshops, and then doing a lot of also like organizational stuff, organizing food sovereignty forums, and this has been also thanks to Pixelache, this practice has been for me on the border between like activism and art, and I was always treating my, for instance, my doing workshops as a kind of art practice. So I was doing workshops at the Art Academy, like zine making workshops at the Art Academy here in Warsaw. And this was my idea of doing art, in that I would not be actually producing anything myself, but facilitating the process in which something happens. So this also extends to my activists and social work. I have a website about this, but it's in Polish. Maybe I'll translate it now that I have a motivation.
I think it's really interesting that so many of us have moved towards process, and that food has become really important to so many people's practice in lots of different ways too. And that the influence of workshops and participatory programs has led to that kind of work too. So thank you for sharing, Wojciech.
Thank you.
Kristen, can I call on you to share?
Yes, hello, Amanda. Thank you for inviting me in. I don't remember when I was at Pixelache, but I know I was probably on some of the very first ones. And also, I don't remember exactly what I did there, but I had a good time, I know. And I was working at the time a lot with a kind of network between Nordic and Baltic countries. And I was the director of Atelier Nord in Oslo, Norway, media lab for artists. We were also doing some workshops together with some of the people involved in Pixelache. And yeah, all in all, I just have fond memories, but since I don't remember them, I will not relate them. I'll go straight to what's happening now. And I have two things that I want to present to you very shortly that might be interesting for some of you. One thing is this project, Oslofjord Ecologies, which has been a four or five year long kind of activity project. It started as a workshop and has ended now as a book. And this book you can download from Acoustic Space for free on PDF. And it relates our experiences so far. So we have worked as an interdisciplinary, very loose group. I have been the project leader. We have been part of the network Renewable Futures, that some of you might know, which is also Nordic, Baltic, something or more international, perhaps, since 2008. But this project has the name Oslo in it, so it is a bit more, I will put later this address where you can download the book in the chat, so you can all have a look at it. So it's interdisciplinary, as I said, between different types of researchers, some academics, some artists, some biologists, but the art practices are very widespread from the people who are inside here. So that was one thing. And the second thing, then I want to just show you a website. I hope that will work. This one coming up. Can you see this? Hopefully, yeah. So I work in a university in Oslo, which is called Oslo Met. And together with colleagues working with robotics and, the IT ICT researchers actually made the initiative, and we have started to work together on this project, Felt Futures of Living Technologies. We started now in October. We are financed for 3 years as a research, artistic research project. So it's driven by artistic research. We have a PhD candidate, Hege Tapio, maybe some of you know her, and we are hiring a postdoc, which will soon be in place. So this is in Norwegian, but it is possible to find the English version here. So here you find some information. It's quite institutional and boring in a way, but it's a way to get in contact. And we will arrange an event or a conference exhibition next November, from the 4th to the 6th of November. We will do something in Oslo, but it will for sure be online as well as physical. So welcome to that. I think that's my 5 minutes, and I will post the address for the book in the chat for everyone. Thanks.
Please do. That was really great, Kristen. Thank you very much. And through a small irony, I also was just chatting only yesterday with Hege. So there you go. Everything comes in circles. Everything comes in circles. And so now I'm going to give us another 10-minute break. We're still waiting on a couple of people who are going to give final presentations, but consider the break a time for open mic to ask one another questions or follow up with things that you would like up. I can see some people arriving for the final group. So we'll have another 10 minutes or just under, and I'll start you off. David, I will probably get you to start off the next group of presentations, if that's all right.
Sure.
In about 10 minutes. But in the meantime, people, please, it's an open mic, ask one another questions. Talk about what you're up to if you're not giving a formal presentation. And I'm going to take it, I'm going to stretch my leg because I've been sitting here the whole time.
Hello. This is the streaming equivalent of dead air. But it's been a long stream.
Hey.
I think it's absolutely normal Finnish conversation. I don't see anything strange about it.
Good point, Antti.
Yeah, I can do a puppet show for the streamers also.
Maybe we'll the final round of presentations.
So who does this every day?
David is going to kick us off. Is David back yet?
What?
Oh, are you going to kick us off for the final round of...
Totally, I never left. I mean, container, it's cold outside.
You were sitting so still, it looked like it was a screenshot.
Oh, that's my Swedish me. You know, I became Swedish after so many years in Sweden. Anyway, so...
You have 5 minutes of reflection, David.
Yeah, let's go for it. So first of all, welcome to my office. I've been sitting here since March, and I wrote in the spreadsheet that I thought I was at Pixelache in 2007, but I think it was like 2009, maybe. It was definitely not 2008 because that's the year my daughter was born, and that year we went to Argentina instead. Because when you have a baby, you have to go to Argentina, right? That's what people do. But the one thing I remember from Pixelache was going to the sauna. This is a fact. You know, I remember being at the museum, walking around and going to the sauna and going out, eating sausages and crawling in the snow. And that was nice. But just to give you some context of what it is that I've been doing lately, I will just share with you my browser. So I think one of the places where I put a lot of time is in Arduino, and as one of the founders of the Arduino platform, I try to just keep the craziness in it, the craziness we had when we created it. As Arduino becomes a company with over 100 employees, I think just trying to keep people sane by being stupid is my role. So I'm the founder that shows up in Christmas videos, doing stupid stuff, and tries to defend that we should allow people to subscribe with whatever gender option they want into their user profiles at the company and stuff like this. Like one of the latest things I'm involved in is removing the words master and slave from all of the definitions of the I2C protocol. It's going to take several months, but we're gonna get it there. For example, we talk about Scrum, we don't talk about Scrum Master, we talk about Scrum Wizard. So it was a pretty long discussion as well. So how to use language in a more inclusive way and how to discuss different things is something that we are all very concerned with. And once you have something like Arduino that has thousands and thousands of documentation pages, millions of users in the community forum, implementing some of these changes sometimes actually not really welcomed by people. You will be surprised how many people are homophobic in the tech world, or you will not be surprised. But every time we publish like a rainbow flag or whatever, we lose 100 users. On the other hand, we win another 100 users. So who the fuck cares, right? But what has happened in the last years is that at around 2016, I became an Ashoka Fellow. I don't know if you're familiar with the Ashoka Foundation, but it's a foundation created by some people that somehow went out from McKinsey to create a foundation to work with the greater good, for the greater good. And I was invited to be an Ashoka Fellow in 2016, I think. And so I had this very funny moment where me being a anarcho-socialist Republican had to go see the King of Spain. So, and I broke all of the whole protocol. First of all, you get this email that says that you're supposed to be wearing a suit. You're supposed to be wearing like shoes and stuff. And I was coming from Sweden, and that day in Sweden it was snowing like crazy. So I came down from Spain with my winter boots. And it looked like I was a security guard for one of the ladies that I went together with. And then when you pose for the pictures, it says very clearly you have to have your hands on the sides or like holding the fingers like this at the bottom. And I went in the picture with cross arms. Regardless, even though I broke all of the rules of protocol, I actually made it to the first picture of the royal family's website that day. So I'm pretty glad. So I broke all of the rules of protocol, and I proved that there is room for people like me in the world still. But also in the last years, I finished my doctoral thesis, and this was a really complicated task. It took me 15 years. And it took a lot of extra time because of administration problems. Like I had to change university, they lost my papers, I had to retake courses, and write the final book was hard, but it was even harder to deal with the printing house because me being a digital person, I tend to believe that everything that is on a file can be transposed to or transmitted to the physical world. And so this book that you see here had bleeding edges, like the ink was doing like a pattern on the side of the book. And turns out that's really hard to make in contemporary printing houses. Even though it was offset printing, this was not digital printing. Oh, sorry, it was digital printing, but with kind of like a semi-offset machine anyway, because it was a lot of copies. Then the last year, I got very involved with the coronavirus makers movement in Spain. And this is a movement that emerged from people's living rooms while people got locked down in Spain. There was a lot of clever people that were forced to stay at home, and they weren't allowed out for 106 days. So we created a whole social movement where people collaborated to create personal protection equipment. And we produced about 1 million protection face shields, which is a world record. It's the country in the world that made the most face shields per inhabitant. It was also an interesting thing from an organizational perspective, like how people self-organize by region and then by country. And there were different networks. Some people did working with research and development, some people working with different things. And I was, since everybody was locked at home, even though I was in Sweden, nobody really cared. So I was like, I was there, but without being there. And I took the role of the fundraiser. So I went out getting funding for the whole movement and making sure there was money to buy more materials and transport things from place to places, you know. On the Department of Crazy Stuff, we got the army to fly a doctor from the Canary Islands all the way to the peninsula because he was going
We lost audio there. Components.
And so we got everything done with no money. Then, since I was kind of missing the craziness of the Pixelache and Pixel days and stuff, I ended up joining a different community. I don't know if you're familiar with this community that is called Sketching in Hardware. And it's a community of doers that arrange a yearly conference. And it's a little bit like this meeting today. Everybody gets 16 minutes to talk about what they did the last year. The people in this community come from a lot of different places, just like here. There is craftsmen, there is computer researchers, there is MIT graduates, there is Indian renegades working in secret labs, you know, it's everything. And there is a yearly topic and you're welcome to come. And then we do a project together and build something together for 3 days. So this year was very strange because, of course, building something together online was a really hard thing. And then on the department of really weird things, what I also do is I write books about dead programming languages. So my latest book is out, the Java Workshop. So if you're interested, I can give you a $5 discount. If the Kindle costs $5.30, you can get it for 30 cents. So, you know, but it's a book looking at Java, at contemporary Java. I think Java is not dead. I think Java has still a lot to say on security, on servers and stuff. And I think it's a really good book. Not that I made it, but the people I wrote it with, they were really knowledgeable. And so I did the easy chapters. They did the hard chapters. So yeah, that's my life in the last years, people. That and cats.
I have also admitted to cats too, David. There are three who've wandered past my screen at one point or another during our presentations this morning. But yeah, Villa's asked to see the cat. Eric's not interested. He's allergic to them, so he can't even look at them apparently. Evelyn and Dmitry, it's lovely to see you join us. I'm wondering if you would be prepared to give us your 5-minute reflection next.
We'll happily.
Thank you, Amanda. It's lovely to see everyone, even in this matrix format.
Yeah.
And we are now at the Canary Islands, so we just
escaped.
Went for a swim and we are back at your digital gathering. So we didn't prepare anything. The only reason we wanted to tune in to this meeting is to give our deepest thanks for the Pixelache experience and how important this exhibition was to us. So we came to Pixelache in 2008. And I think that was the first time when we showed Camera Lucida, the Sonic Chemical Observatory, in the real full regulated museum setting, which was quite a challenge because I think it was really on the threshold of legality and what is allowed or not allowed. It was basically a transgression of museum practice. And running this piece is quite complicated as well. So coming from the deepest wound of the underground, it was amazing to have our installation at Kiasma. Also, I did a presentation with Helen Evans. And this is how we met Hehe, which is the friendship that continues to this day. And Hehe presented another mind-blowing project, which was the Green Cloud, which is another quite impossible artwork. And I also remember this sauna with sitting naked on the street of Helsinki and eating sausages. That's unforgettable. That's an unforgettable experience. So we also met during this exhibition, we met Temu Arena, who is not an artist. At that time, he was a young entrepreneur and now he's heading the biohacker scene of
Helsinki.
Of Helsinki, well, and Finland. Yeah. And we've been invited by the Biohacker Summit to present our artworks in Helsinki many times ever since, and because of that, we also went further into Finnish
wilderness.
Nature and wilderness, and spent a few nights in the woods under the sky. So Pixelache was really a start of some very, very beautiful things in our life, and we just wanted to say thank you, and that we miss this. We miss Pixelache. We miss that what it was bringing to us.
But vis-a-vis the current imbroglio, coincidentally, about a year before the pandemic began, we launched a research project focusing on the microscopic living matter in the air. It's a project called Aerobiome. And it's quite extraordinary to fathom that in a cubic meter of air, we can encounter hundreds of thousands of microorganisms, of which hundreds of different taxa are represented. And this rather embryonic field of aerobiology is so significant, not only because we're dealing with one of the most significant players in geochemistry, in the geochemical cycles, life-sustaining cycles, but also in terms of atmospheric dynamics, and of course, in terms of all of the pathogens and pollutants that reside also in the air that we breathe.
So in 2019, we offered three workshops, three aerobiome workshops, sampling air at the New Institute Museum in Rotterdam and other sites in Rotterdam and the Netherlands. And we even offered an opportunity for people to bring their own sample of air in a plastic bag or any other container, and then we will incubate it and grow its bacterial contents. We were rather surprised how very little interest was from the usual museum goers to this kind of a workshop, and there was very little of a symbiotic mindset. So when people hear bacteria in the air, they get paranoid,
squeamish. Or even worse, fungal spores.
Yes, so that was a bit of a surprise for us. But when I imagined this kind of a global catastrophe, a total collapse of the biosphere, I imagine how the oxygen content in the air goes low, just a few percent will be enough that everything that breathes suffocates and dies within minutes. And actually people dying from COVID-19 who are suffocating, it's this kind of the lack of oxygen, not because it's not enough oxygen in the air, but because your body cannot take enough. And it's a very fine line. And we have to understand that our atmosphere, it is not a stationary chemical composition. It's a very unstable biochemical byproduct. I like to call it a living organ. So it's constantly produced and reproduced by living organisms. So if we disbalance or destroy it, it can be quite catastrophic. So in a way, thinking about it with COVID-19 is a very deep, interesting question. Thank you very much.
Super interesting. I'm loving hearing what you're up to now, and I've been taking notes. And please do share links in the chat. I'd love to hear that. I think at this point, that's the last of the formal 5-minute reflections that we've got, but I'd love to open the floor to anybody who has additional comments or reflections or things that they'd like to add or histories or futures that they'd like to share with us. Unless, is that Pete Gomez who's just arrived? Maybe he can't hear me.
I would like to hear a bit more on how one can pack air.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you.
you, Pete.
Yeah, sorry, I think I got kicked out for potential Zoom bombing. So I've had to log in off my phone, and any of the things I was going to show you are not on here.
My apologies. So, it was just because okay. It was a number, and I didn't know if it was you. Or
yeah, don't worry. Anyone. Don't worry. It's fine. It's just that I can chat to you, but I had some things to show which I can't quite do in the way I was anticipating. My slot's not right now yet. Anyway, is it?
Yeah, it kind of is. We're right at the the end of our gathering. But if you want to hop off and hop back, welcome.
I don't think it will be enough time now for me to reconfigure things. I'll just shoot from my
shoot from the hip. Give us your five.
Shoot from the hip.
What are you up to now, Pete?
So I was going to kind of give you a little bit of a flavour of some things. I'll show you what I've got on my machine that I would have showed you. So just to give you a little idea of shifts in technology, I was trying to get people to back to where we were around that time. I think this is from around about 2003, 2004. Can you see that?
Yeah, we can.
We were at the kind of probably the late period of locative media at that point. All obsessed by GPS. My work was at that time was making chalk drawings. I was never particularly interested in technology in that sense. I'm not sure where my motivation came from, but it was not around. It wasn't really around the technical sides of the GPS, because what I was doing at that time was incredibly low tech. You know, it was. I was using chalk, I was drawing, I was walking. Oh, hello, Kat. And so my starting point was, on retrospect, you know, we were all very obsessed by GPS and notions of location. And with some time and distance, I think for me personally as an artist, there was a lot to do with orientation going on. And I think that was orientation of the self, orientation within a changing world in a way. You know, it wasn't, I don't want to labor the point, but there was certainly something along those lines going on. And the drawing I made outside Kiasma was near the station in Helsinki. And I'm not sure whether it's documented or not. I think it is on video, but it would be on tape. So that's interesting in itself. And there was there's the potential of non-documentation, you know, what not as intentional as Capro or along the lines of just not doing it, but they were very ephemeral works. They were washed away by the rain and they suddenly didn't exist. So if they weren't documented, they were just gone. And I was kind of reflecting on this idea that we were this roving gang of artists at the time who were rocking up in different European cities. And effectively, the other thing I was thinking is effectively we were exploring, you know, pre-smartphone technologies through kind of conceptual investigations. But very interestingly, certainly from now, that wasn't framed under the term research. Now it would be the primary term that would be used to categorize and define those kind of explorations. They would be firmly set within those conceptual terms, whereas then that really wasn't a term that was very prevalent, certainly not as it is now. There was a difference. So I think that's worth noting, that there has been this change. So for now, I've been doing research for the last few years, doctoral research, and sort of at the tail end, really. And I really moved away from technology around about what I thought was moving away from technology in around about 2005, towards working with actors, making films, working with acting theory and performance. And this led to an ongoing interest in improvisation. So I realized now these chalk drawings I was making were, they were improvised to some degree. They were, I didn't frame them in those terms. But the two things that have carried through is exploration of improvisation and also diagramming. So I've been developing a new model for making films using improvisation, which involves an ensemble practice using improvisation of the camera, of sound, of performance. So it's a kind of jazzy type conceptual framework, but what I've done is I've developed a model that's teachable. So it's a teachable form of improvised filmmaking. And this is a very new field. It's barely been defined. It's kind of got contested terminologies and it doesn't really exist as a genre as yet. And that's partly been some of the areas that I've been explaining. But just to give you an idea, give me 2 seconds. This gives you an idea of that. If you didn't know what I was doing then, this isn't from Helsinki, this is from London, but that was me globally positioning a sack of rubbish in the East End of London as part of a performance. But that just, that hopefully articulates the kind of low-tech diffraction of how I was thinking around utilizing technologies. I'll just show you a little bit of the model I've been working on. It's very involved and I can't really show you comprehensively now, but I'll give you an idea. Sorry, I'm just trying to, this would have all been done on a machine, but I'm doing 2 things at the same time here. Hang on a minute. Oh, is that going to work? Sorry, 1 second. Okay, so the model I've been working on, this is, I'm waiting for this to settle down a little bit, but it's a way of rethinking production of a film project by going through a series of games and exercises that allow individuals to understand a way of working that is based on shifting relational conditions. So rather than having prefixed structures about how, just to give you a bit clearer thing, rather than having preset structures about how a sequence or a film narrative might unfold, they are components of movement, framing, camera, and interrelational dynamics that allow people to read what's going on. So during an unfolding of improvisation, these are tools that get learned, or kind of techniques and improvisational strategies that are learned and understood. So when they unfold in a particular situation, i.e. the camera moves in an unexpected direction, or an actor does something unexpected, there are ways of accommodating those things without being surprised. So I've been working on ways of sharing strategies that allow that way of working. And I think this is related a lot to finding ways to, the world exists in this kind of continual dynamic. And this is a way of trying to begin to find ways of thinking that prioritize ways of adaptation and improvisation to shifting relational conditions. So that's kind of way I'm thinking at the moment. And strangely, it does relate very strongly back to the diagramming outside Helsinki, but from a slightly different position. So those are the things that are interesting me, but I think it comes down to new forms and structures of operating and working and ways of interacting. You know, I've been really immersed in Barad, and it's been a really insightful and powerful shift in how I think about how the world operates on many different levels. So that's kind of where I am. I don't know whether that was related to anything that's gone before.
No, it's perfect, Pete. Thank you so much for sharing that.
I can't see everyone. I can only see you, Amanda. I can't see everybody else at the moment because my phone is, I've got limited gallery view.
Yeah, well, you'll get me or you'll get somebody who talks. So if people want to talk to Pete or ask him a question, if you speak, it'll probably come up on his screen.
Yeah, the chat I can't see at the moment because it's a bit complicated interface-wise, but...
I think that with that, you're actually our final presentation.
Ah, so, well, just in time.
Exactly in time. We've got, and we're finishing more or less on time too, but we can open the floor to conversation or if people have additional things they want to add. We are also collecting links. So Pete, if you can share those links with Andrew or myself, then we'll add that to our spreadsheet for the resource that we're building.
I will do. Most of that work isn't yet published, but soon.
Goody. That's really brilliant to see where people are at and how people have grown and developed and gone backwards to go forwards. It's been a really rewarding morning for me, afternoon or evening for you guys.
I've got to say, Pixelake really does, it occupies a very special place for me, partly because it always confused me, which I really liked. It always managed to present multiple things at the same time, which made you have to orientate yourself, and it wasn't given to you. Nothing is ever given to you. And I think that's one of the key things for me. It always managed to articulate levels of complexity that other festivals didn't.
It's nice that you say that, Pete. I'm gonna think my microphone is actually on, but I can hear the reverberation in the room. But the entanglements that people have mentioned, either through their personal stories or through their works, through how one thing led to another, was nicely summarized in the end also with your referencing. And it's really interesting to have a period of time now, we've had 4 hours of hearing different perspectives, because as you've gathered, some of us who've been involved for a while also can't describe very well. Some of the people who have been outsiders looking in don't really know what's going on. And then the persons who come and regularly attend and also value that ambiguity. And it's interesting to hear the echoes and connections between people's presentations and thoughts, both the reflective ones and also what they do now, because it gives an idea of how that's a valuable thing, how we don't need to understand things clearly, but that actually the processes that are explored in that rather intimate scaled festival, with all the things that we don't know that are emerging, we don't really understand, how they can have value and create value over a longer period of time. And it may be that the clarity is only 10 years later, 15 years later, etc. But it's very interesting to hear this in this sort of compact mediated experience that we've had today. So thank you everybody for their sharing and contributions. It's also really great to have someone as experienced and wise in the scene as Amanda moderating for us, because you also made the very nice connections between things in a super smooth way. So I thank you for that.
Being an outsider is helpful.
indeed. I think it's good to go back to the open conversation. That was my thanks to Amanda as our host, and then to all of you as contributors to this event. Thank you, Steve, and the side who's been technical support, and I appreciate all of you.
No worries. I didn't always do a good job, but I did it.
So when is next Pixelache?
Oh, I could say that the festival takes place next year from 6th to 13th of June, 2021. And if all is well, it will take place in the Central Library of Helsinki called Holiday. And you can learn more about it from festivals.pixelake.ac. We have an open call at the moment, which is for audio works, which is open until the middle of January. Thank you for the reminder.
Zinat, do you have a formal contribution you'd like to share, or?
Oh, Zinat, great.
Hi, I see that I'm later on in the schedule, so I'll just come back.
Oh no, we're right at the end of our whole program. So.
Really?
We're in closing remarks at the moment.
I literally just popped in, so all I will say is hello, everybody.
Lovely to see you. Lovely to see you.
Yeah.
Please, Zina, tell us what you're doing these days. Don't just get off that easy.
So I took part in Pixelache in 2006, and it was while I was doing my master's at the University of Art and Design in Helsinki, what is now called Aalto. And Andrew was also there in the department at the time.
Sort of, yeah.
Sort of, yes. Pixelache was where we featured our thesis project. So I collaborated with a fellow student, Richard Wiederberg, with our project called Improve. And it was about improvising with distributed sound, recorded live by participants. And we did it at the Helsinki railway station, where I believe Pete Gomez was also doing his locative media art workshop.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Correct, yeah.
And now, so it was what I did at Pixelache and what I'm doing now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right now, I'm teaching design in this university in Linnaeus, in Växjö, in Småland, better known as kind of the home of IKEA, but also the father of the imperialist father of biology, Carl Linné. Today, I just happened to be in a workshop space of the little pink maker. She's sitting there, where we're collaborating with a few Sami reindeer herders to see what we can make out of reindeer poo. And so right now we've been working on paper out of it. So we've been cleaning our hands a lot more than usual as well.
I think we're all doing that for different reasons.
Oh.
Awesome, that was perfect.
So that was that. Thank you for listening.
That's awesome. It's really lovely, it'll be a terrific addition to the archive. Now I'm just going to take a group portrait again because I can't help it, because you all look so lovely. Group portrait, everyone. Thank you. Thank you for a really wonderful conversation. I feel totally privileged to have been able to be a fly on the wall for all of this and facilitate the conversation. And I can't wait to see what happens with the archive. And I love that we've all looked back in order to look forward, because the past, the present, and the future are always essential for thinking about where we belong in the world. Been a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for inviting me. Thank you.
So much.
Oh,
nice to see you guys.
Mm. Hello,
everyone. Bye. Bye, Pete.
Hello.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Hey, Sophia. Nice to see you.
Hey.